nose hurt?
Yeah.
Does your toothpaste contain sage, eucalyptus, myrrh, chamomile?
All that in one toothpaste?
Yes, try Colgate Herbal. Colgate Herbal contains nature's best herbs and Colgate's fluoride technology to give you strong teeth and healthy gums.
Ah, Colgate Herbal.
Let's go. Colgate Herbal for strong teeth and healthy gums naturally.
Explorers of the night, wale wasi wakuhasol usiku, kustrima movies, music mix diehards, and gaming fanatics. We've heard you. It is now your time to fly your flag high. Do what you love, mpaka che na Telkom. Join Usiku Sako with Telkom night bundles that allow you rule the night at prices you love. Join our tribe, Usiku Sako Squad. Just dial *544# from your Telkom line and select the night bundle of your dreams. You are the legend. The night needs.
Sona Moja imetengenezwa kwa njia speciali ili kupambana na maumivu kwa haraka. Sona Moja ina aspirin kama kiungo. Sona Moja, kitulizo kamili. Maumivu ya kizidi, pata ushauri wa daktari.
We are still trying to adjust to our new normal life, but we will get there. We are all looking for effective ways to keep our homes, shopping outlets, work and eatery spaces safe. Worry not, we keep you safe. Use Ace Disinfectant to disinfect all your surfaces at home and in public places, building entrances, corridors, stairways, lifts, wash areas, switches, doorknobs, countertops, shopping trolleys, public service vehicles. Ace Disinfectant kills 99.9% of germs. Ace, we make your house feel brand new.
Nimeosha mikono, osha yako.
Nimeosha mikono, osha yako.
Ikiwezekana fanyia kazi kwako.
Ikiwezekana fanyia kazi kwako.
Hata Mungu muabudie kwako.
Hata Mungu muabudie kwako.
Yuko kila pahali. Atakusikia.
Ombe ya wale imeshafika kwao. Ashinde kifo.
Mazake Mungu ashinde kifo.
Nawe jizuie.
Nawe jizuie.
Ni kwa muda tu tutashinda.
Have you filed your 2019 tax returns? You have few days remaining. Do it today and avoid the last minute rush. Log on to itax.kra.go.ke. The County Government of Nyeri, with the approval of His Excellency Governor Mutahi Kahiga, has granted a 100% waiver of accrued interest sums on outstanding land rates, which has been extended to 30th June 2020. With a cashless system, obtain your invoice from respective sub-county offices and make payments through accounts held at Cooperative Bank or Kenya Commercial Bank Nyeri branch using account numbers on your screen, or M-Pesa Paybill 191900 and get your official receipt.
This is NTV.
Na mtazamaji, picha tunazoona ni za moja kwa moja kutoka mahakamani ambapo kesi imekuwa ikiendelea, na leo ilikuwa ni siku ya kutolewa kwa hukumu, na kwa sasa hakimu katika kesi hiyo anatoa ama anaandika hukumu yake kuhusiana na kesi ambayo inamkabili mbunge wa Sirisia John Waluke pamoja na Grace Wahungu ambaye ni mkurugenzi wa kampuni ya bidhaa ya Erad General, ikiwa ni kesi ambayo inahusisha na sakata ya mahindi ya mwaka 2004 ambapo walipatikana na hatia ya ufisadi, ambapo mali ya shilingi 297 milioni za mahindi zilipotea, ama ufisadi ambao unahusisha shilingi milioni 297 katika sakata hiyo ya mahindi. Nadaiwa kuwa Waluke na Wahungu waligushi stakabadhi ili kupokea malipo kutoka katika bodi ya nafaka na mazao nchini. Na baada ya kusikizwa kwa pande zote, leo ilikuwa ni siku ya kutolewa hukumu, na pande zote zikapata kusikilizwa, na kwa sasa inatarajiwa hukumu ipate kutolewa wakati wowote kutoka sasa, na ndiposa tunasubiria hilo ili kupata kusikia hukumu itakuwa ni ya aina gani ambayo itakuwa ikitolewa katika kikao hicho. Kwa hivyo ndizo picha ambazo tumekuwa tukikuletea za moja kwa moja kutoka awali leo, kuendelea kuangazia hali hizo, na pia kuna mengine ambayo tumekuandalia katika NTV jioni hii leo ambayo tutakuwa tukiyagusia kwa sasa kwa kifupi, ili tupate kujua ni masuala gani ambayo tunaangazia katika NTV jioni kwa muhtasari, kisha tutakuwa tukirejea wakati ambapo hukumu hiyo itakuwa inatolewa ili tupate kusikia hukumu hiyo.
County governments and their readiness to respond to new imported cases of infection will also equally largely determine our national readiness to reopen the country.
Sasa kufunguliwa nchi kunategemea utayari wa kaunti yako katika kukabiliana na maambukizi ya virusi vya corona. Wafanyabiashara wa Gikomba Nairobi lalamikia hasara kubwa inayotokana na visa vya moto.
We will assist to make sure that the people that are identified are not only doing kitchen gardens for themselves, but with time they become as a pilot they are able to teach others.
Mradi wa kukuza mashamba madogo na kuwa makubwa nchini umeanzishwa Makueni.
Mbashara kutoka jumba la Nation. Hii ni NTV jioni na Daniel Mule.
Naam, karibu tena mtazamaji kwa taarifa hizo na nyingine kwa kina. Kumbuka picha ambazo tumekuwa tukuletea moja kwa moja kutoka mahakamani ni hukumu ambayo inasubiriwa kutolewa na hakimu hapo katika mahakama hiyo ambayo inamhusisha mbunge wa Sirisia John Waluke ambaye ameshtakiwa pamoja na mkurugenzi wa kampuni ya bidhaa ya Erad General ambaye ni Grace Wahungu, na hukumu hiyo inatarajiwa kutolewa muda wote kutoka sasa. Hakimu tayari ameshaiandika hukumu yake na anatarajiwa kuitoa wakati wote kutoka sasa, kwa hivyo tutakuwa tukirejea kusikiliza. Kumbuka tu John Waluke ameshtakiwa na anahusishwa na sakata ya mahindi ya mwaka 2004 ambapo mali ya shilingi milioni 297 zilipotea. Kwa hivyo tutakuwa tukirejea hapo kuisikiza hukumu hiyo itakapokuwa ikitolewa, na hii leo wamepata fursa pande zote mbili, ikiwa ni pande ya washtakiwa pamoja na upande wa mashtaka kutoa kauli zao za mwisho mwisho baada ya ili kusubiriwa kwa hukumu hiyo ambayo itakuwa ikitolewa muda wote kutoka sasa. Na tukiangazia taarifa nyingine, kwa mara nyingine wafanyabiashara wa Gikomba wanakadiria hasara kubwa baada ya moto kuteketeza vibanda katika sehemu kubwa ya kufanyia biashara katika soko hilo. Nyumba za makazi pia ziliteketea huku familia kadhaa zikisalia bila makao. Serikali inasema imewajengea wafanyabiashara hao sehemu nzuri, imewajengea wafanyabiashara hao sehemu nzuri ambapo watakuwa wakifanyia biashara zao ili kupunguza hasara wanazopata kila kunapotokea mikasa kama hiyo.
Moto huo ulianza mwendo wa saa 8 usiku wa kuamkia leo, wakati ambapo wafanyikazi walikuwa wamefunga biashara zao. Walioathirika zaidi ni wafanyibiashara wanaoishi katika soko hilo, kwani biashara zao na nyumba za makazi ziliteketea. Zimamoto walifika saa 3 baadaye na kuzima moto huo uliokuwa bado unateketeza vibanda, huku wafanyibiashara wakijaribu kuokoa mali yoyote ambayo wangeweza. Serikali imeutaja mkasa huu kama wa kusababishwa makusudi, huku ikiwakashifu waliohusika.
This was not an accident. This was a deliberate planned fire, and we would like the government to take to leave no stone unturned to make sure that the culprits are brought to book.
Japo mikasa hii imekuwa ikitajwa kuwa ya kusababishwa na sio ajali, hakuna washukiwa ambao wamewahi kutiwa mbaroni. Serikali imeahidi kujenga ukuta kuzingira soko hili katika kipindi cha miezi mitatu na kuweka kamera za CCTV ili kuimarisha usalama sokoni.
With immediate effect, we are going to assemble them together and give each one of them 10,000 shillings so that they can be able to sort the small issues they may have.
Wafanyabiashara waliopoteza mali yao yote wanalaumu zimamoto wakisema wana mazoea ya kufika wamechelewa.
Kitna kuna makladi, kuna vitu most, kuna watu wenye wanauza ma vitu zenye zina spread fire mbio mbaya. Sunaona sasa ndio wanachangamka ati ndio wanataka sasa kuzimazima vitu zenye vitu zishaungua kila kitu.
Serikali inasema itatumia kati ya shilingi milioni 23 na 25 kuwasaidia waliopoteza makao kufuatia mkasa huo.
Na mtazamaji, tukisonga mbele kuangazia masuala ya COVID-19 nchini, ni kuwa Rais Uhuru Kenyatta leo ametangaza kwamba taifa litafunguliwa kuendelea na shughuli za kawaida ikiwa tu maagizo ya kukabiliana na virusi vya korona yatafuatwa ipasavyo. Hata hivyo, kulingana na baraza la magavana, ni kaunti 12 ambazo hadi sasa zina vitanda 300 ambavyo vinahitajika kuwahudumia wagonjwa wa COVID ikiwa idadi itaongezeka kama inavyoshuhudiwa sasa. Hayo yakijiri, Wizara ya Afya imezindua kituo cha kutoa huduma za matibabu ya akili kwa wahudumu wa afya ambao wanawahudumia wagonjwa wa corona. Leo kumetangazwa Wakenya 178 zaidi ambao walipatikana na virusi. Leila Mohamed ana maelezo zaidi.
Siku 11 kabla ya kuisha kwa muda wa siku 30 wa kuendelea kufungwa kwa kaunti ya Mombasa na Nairobi Metropolitan, Rais Kenyatta amekutana na baraza la magavana kwa njia ya teknolojia ili kupata ufahamu wa uwezo wa kaunti kukabiliana na COVID-19.
County governments and their readiness to respond to new imported cases of infection will also equally largely determine our national readiness to reopen the country as a whole.
Hiyo jana, baraza la magavana liliitaka serikali kuwapa fedha ambazo wanasema ni muhimu kuwasaidia kununua vifaa na vitanda vinavyohitajika katika hospitali kuu za kaunti. Zaidi ya siku 100 baada ya kisa cha kwanza kuripotiwa nchini, idadi ya maambukizi imepanda hadi 5384 baada ya watu 178 zaidi kuthibitishwa kuwa na virusi.
Nairobi is leading today with 100 cases, followed by Kajiado with 21. We have Migori having 17, Kiambu 16, Busia 8, Mombasa 7.
Idadi ya waliokufa imepanda hadi 182 baada ya wawili kufariki, huku 34 wakipata nafuu na kuruhusiwa kwenda nyumbani. Aidha, serikali inaendelea na maandalizi ya kuhakikisha uangalizi wa nyumbani wa wagonjwa unakuwa na ufanisi.
60,000 community health volunteers. And again, this was done through just a mobile phone.
Wizara pia itachunguza kupungua kwa simu zinazopigwa. Huduma ya afya kimezinduliwa.
Doctors, nurses, lab people, they also cry. They feel pain.
Ni kupitia mfumo huu wa digitali ambapo wahudumu wa afya sasa wanatarajiwa kupokea huduma za matibabu za kiakili kuwezesha kuweza kutoa huduma zao vilivyo.
The people across the country, actually in 45 counties, that can be called upon to be able to provide the psychosocial support to all these healthcare workers.
Leila Mohamed, NTV.
Na mtazamaji, tunaendelea na NTV jioni, na kama nilivyokudokezea awali ni kuwa muda wote kutoka sasa tutakuwa tukirejesheni mahakamani kupata kuisikiza hukumu katika kesi dhidi ya mbunge wa Sirisia John Waluke ambaye ameshtakiwa pamoja na Grace Wahungu ambaye ni mkurugenzi wa kampuni ya bidhaa ya Erad General baada ya wili hao kupatikana na hatia ya sakata ya mahindi katika mwaka wa 2004. Kwa hivyo tutakuwa tukirejea kule muda wote kutoka sasa hukumu hiyo itakapokuwa inaanza kusomwa. Lakini tukisonga mbele tu, kuna mengine mengi hapa, tunaangazia masuala ya usalama. na shughuli za biashara zilitatizwa katika eneo la Lesos, kaunti ya Nandi, baada ya makabiliano kati ya maafisa wa polisi na wenyeji. Mapambano yalitokana na mauaji ya mlemavu ambaye anasemekana kufyatuliwa risasi alipokuwa akisihi polisi amwachilie mhudumu wa bodaboda ambaye hakuwa na barakoa. Gabriel Kudaka anaarifu zaidi.
Walio shuhudia kisa hicho walisema mwenda zake Lazaro Tirop aliuawa baada ya ugomvi kuibuka alipokuwa ameenda kumsisha afisa polisi kumwachilia jamaa aliyekuwa amekamatwa kwa kukosa kitambaa cha kufunika pua na mdomo.
Ni mtu mwenye ni mgonjwa, juzi tumefanyia harambee, ni mlemavu, miguu inamsumbua. Ugonjwa haijamua lakini wameua kwa risasi tatu.
Mamia ya wenyeji waliandamana kutaka afisa aliyehusika na mauaji akamatwe. Aidha waliwazuia polisi kuondoa mwili kwenye eneo la tukio.
Mtu angali hapa, tuko na uchungu sana kwa sababu mtu ameuawa bure bila hatia.
Tumechoka sana na tabia ya askari ya kutudhulumu na kutuua. Waliua mtu hapa na sasa wamerudia mara ya pili.
Polisi walilazimika kufyatua risasi hewani na kutumia vitoa machozi ili kuwatawanya waandamanaji walioharibu mali yakiwemo makao ya maafisa wa polisi.
Haiwezekani, hawatabaki.
Viongozi wa eneo hili wakiongozwa na Governor Stephen Sang pamoja na commissioner wa kaunti hiyo Olaka Kutwa waliwatuliza waandamanaji na kuhakikishia kuwa haki itatendeka.
Huyu mwenye amelala hapa kwa mujibu ya sheria, hiyo haki lazima itafanywa.
Gabriel Kudaka, NTV.
Na hakika ni swala ambalo linahitaji kuchunguzwa kabisa. Na mtazamaji, tunaenda mapumzikoni katika NTV jioni, tunarejea na mengi. Kumbuka pia tungali kule mahakamani kufuatilia kesi dhidi ya mbunge wa Sirisia John Waluhi. Kwa hivyo endelea kutazama NTV.
Je, maumivu ya kichwa yanakosesha amani? Kaluma Strong hutuliza maumivu ya kichwa, maumivu ya mwili na hata uondoa joto jingi mwilini. Kaluma Strong ina aspirin kama kiungo. Maumivu yakizidi, muone daktari.
When I'm on nights so restless, tissue makes my days worthless. I need to recharge energy. Get a full night's sleep with Always Ultra. For stacks of tissue and no competition. For its long-lasting protection. Long days I'm fearless. Here comes the boss lady. Multitasking flawless.
Always starts now with 50 shillings. Stay happy always.
Oya cheki, kuna vile sahi mziki manze, kuna vile na jipo manze, yani na cheki. Haimaanishi tu tunajibamba, yani vile regular.
Kitu ya muhimu kwanza ni kujua hali yako ya status ya HIV.
Kwa hapa hivi tuwapeleke na Rieng, tujue venye manzee tutasaidiana si kama vijana. Na kwa unaogopa kwenda pale hivi kwa clinic, unaweza pitia pale hivi kwa chemist ya mtaa. Uitishe a self-test kit. Na wanauza 500 bob only. Unajitestia tu mtaani, unajua hali yako.
Kwa manze naokeza patikana nao, yani ukwe positive manze, usiogope. Kuna madawa yani jo, kuna counseling manze . Na unaza kula fit yani, alafu unaza piga bado ma exercise kiasi kiasi hivi. Na kama nyo manze ukeza patikana yani ya una manze, usiasi yetu unenda kutafuta tena.
Cheki, ukiweza abstain.
Lakini maji ya kizidi unga,
wrap it before you tap it.
La bila gloves, haiwezi.
Unapoendelea kujikinga kutokana na HIV, tafadhali zingatia taratibu zote za serikali za kujikinga na virusi vya corona.
Afya bora, maisha bora. Jipime, jiinue.
The risk of illness-causing germs is increasing. It is believed that the coronavirus can remain on surfaces in your home for up to 9 days. Touching infected surfaces is one of the ways in which germs spread. Regularly disinfect your floors, countertops, and kitchen surfaces with bleach, and use an effective toilet cleaner inside and outside your toilet bowl. This message is brought to you by Medifact, Jik, and Hapik.
Karibu tena mtazamaji na shukrani kwa kuendelea kutazama NTV jioni. Tunaendelea kusonga mbele na polisi huko Mombasa wamewakamata vijana 9 kwa madai ya kuhusika na wizi wa magari. Na vijana hao walikamatwa usiku kwa mkeleo katika nyumba moja ya kupanga eneo la Nyali. Maafisa wa usalama wanasema waliofumania wakinywa pombe chumbani mwao, na polisi walipata misokoto ya bangi na vileo tofauti pamoja na shilingi 100,000 taslimu. Magari waliopatikana pale yalipelekwa katika kituo cha polisi cha Nyali ambapo yanafanyiwa uchunguzi zaidi, huku vijana wakizuiliwa kituoni wakisubiri kufikishwa mahakamani.
Ni vijana below 30 years ambao nataka kujitajirisha haraka haraka, na hatutakubali kabisa kutafuta utajiri yenye utatoka chasho, kutafuta kuwaibia wananchi wanapofanya kazi watoke chasho, wewe unakuja kuwanyang'anya na kuwaibia. Hatutakubali hiyo. The investigation is still going on, tujue kama kuna network nyingine wanakuanga na gengi kubwa kushinda hapo.
Na serikali kuu ikishirikiana na serikali za kaunti imezindua mradi wa kuwezesha ukuzaji wa mashamba madogo milioni 1 kote nchini. Kulingana na afisa msimamizi katika Wizara ya Kilimo Ann Nyaga, mradi huu utawezesha Kenya kujaza kapu la chakula nchini, hasa wakati huu wa kukabiliana na athari za virusi vya corona. Mradi huu umeanzishwa kupitia wakulima 15,000 katika kaunti ya Makueni.
Group of 23 members, and we are very impressed to see that every member has a kitchen, a home garden back at home, and it's not only consisting of vegetables, but it consists of 5 types of vegetables. It also consists of poultry, and also we are saying we also need to incorporate what you're calling the fish and other sub-sectors so that we can be able to have a more balanced diet.
As Makueni County, we are proud to host yet again this national launch. And we promise to cooperate so that as one of the counties where this project is domiciled, we will assist to make sure that the people that are identified are not only doing kitchen gardens for themselves, but with time they become, as a pilot, they are able to teach others.
Na wakazi wa Lari, kaunti ya Kiambu, wametishia kufungua maji mabwawa yaliyoko katika kufungulia maji katika mabwawa yaliyoko katika sehemu hiyo mpaka maji yaishe endapo serikali haitatatua mzozo ulioko baina yao. Huko Bungoma, baadhi ya viongozi wameanzisha mchakato wa kumtaka rais avunje serikali ya kaunti hiyo. Na kwa taarifa hizo na nyingine ni katika matukio majimboni na Nayoma Sampa.
Viongozi wa kaunti ya Bungoma wanasema wamekusanya saini 60,000 na wanalenga kupata saini 100,000 ili waziwasilishe kwa rais avunje serikali ya kaunti. Wakazi wamewataka wawakilishi wa wadi wafanye kazi na gavana kwa muda uliosalia, kwani hawapo tayari kurudi katika uchaguzi. Wakazi wa mtaa wa Nongo Pir Kitengela, kaunti ya Kajiado, walibomoa daraja lililodaiwa kugharimu shilingi milioni 9 kwa madai ya kuwa mkandarasi alifanya kazi duni. Daraja hilo linasemekana kuwa lilipata nyufa siku 2 baada ya kukamilika. Wamelaumu serikali ya kaunti ya Kajiado, huku wakidai kuwa malalamiko yao hayasikizwi kuhusu utekelezaji wa miradi tofauti. Sasa wameitaka idara ya upelelezi wa jinai DCI ichunguze zabuni zinavyotolewa. Wazazi huko Budalangi, kaunti ya Busia, wameonywa dhidi ya kuwaruhusu wana wao kuogelea katika mabwawa yaliyowazi baada ya mtoto wa darasa la 8 kufa maji katika bwawa la kijiji cha Bugisa. Watoto 10 wanadaiwa kupoteza maisha yao katika hali hiyo hiyo chini ya muda wa miezi 4. Mwili wa mtoto unahifadhiwa katika chumba cha maiti cha hospitali ya Victoria. Wakazi wa Molo, kaunti ya Nakuru, wamelalamikia ongezeko la vifo vya kutatanisha. Hii ni baada ya mwili wa mwanaume wa miaka 54 kupatikana barabarani. Wakazi wamewalaumu polisi wakisema kwamba usalama unaendelea kudorora katika eneo hilo. Wakazi wanataka uchunguzi wa vifo hivyo ufanywe haraka na kuondolea hofu. Mzozo ambao umekuwepo kwa muda kati ya wakazi wa kata 2 katika kaunti ndogo ya Lari kuhusu mahali mabwawa yatajengwa umeibuka tena baada ya wakazi kufunga maji. Wakazi wa Lari wamewalaumu wenzao wa Githirioni kwa kuchimba mtaro kuelekeza maji katika eneo lao na kusababisha mafuriko katika maboma yao. Nayoma Sampao, NTV.
Na mtazamaji, na sasa moja kwa moja tuende mahakamani tukapate kusikiza hukumu inayotolewa dhidi ya mbunge wa Sirisia John Waluke.
So this is the decision of the court. This honorable court has duly considered the submissions by the defense advocate, in particular the submissions by Mr. Kubasu on behalf of the first accused in respect of count one and count two, as well as the submissions by the other defense team led by Mr. Ndieki on the sentence to be imposed. The court agrees with the defense team that from the submissions from the prosecution, both accused are said to be first offenders and they have lived an upright life all their life, and that effort needs to be commended. On the application by the defense to for the court to call further evidence under section 216 of the CPC, the court finds that indeed a pre-sentence report in form of the probation that is being sought could assist the court ascertain certain facts before sentencing the accused person. And the court and even this honorable court has time and again used this mode of report to enable it arrive at a just sentence. However, the law envisaged the pre-sentence report and the probation report to majorly help in decongestion, especially for cases where the court is of the opinion that the sentence likely to be meted out is below the 3 years. On the first and second count, this court agrees that a pre-sentence report could help it arrive at a considerable finding. However, it finds that considering the accused persons are faced with other offenses under their circle, that pre-sentence report may not help them much. So the honorable court is of opinion, and that in this particular case, it does not require a pre-sentence report, and that pre-sentence report will only but echo the plea in mitigation that has been brought forth by the defense team, which the court has taken into record. So it will therefore not be prudent to call for probation report and will delay this matter further. That input of the probation will not have any import on the sentencing, especially on section, on the counts 3 to 5. And equally, the court has also made an observation that pre-sentence report is a discretion of the court, and it is the court which will sua motu call for it when it needs that to be brought forth. On the submissions that the court treats the accused persons with leniency, the court equally agrees that being first offenders at their ages, they deserve some form of leniency. And considering the vast role they have played in the society, as brought forth by the defense submission, in their service in the civil service, and equally the society where they hail from. Being first offenders at their age, as the court said, is commendable. and the court themselves that perhaps that could be the position, because either the law has not caught up with them or they have lived a clean life. So sentencing policy and the law go hand in hand. The policy guides, gives guidelines, but the basis of the sentence rests on the law. So where the law provides a mandatory sentence, the court of law may not have a free hand. But where the court has been given discretion, the same should be exercised judiciously and in the interest of justice. So the on the offences under the ASECA, the court may not have much discretion, as the fines are provided for and the stipulation, particularly section 48 and 48.1 and 48.2 are premised on figures, and those figures can only be ascertained whether they are in each case depending on the circumstances. Mr. Kubasu urged this honorable court to find in the first and second count a figure that he gave of 100,000 in each count, and he cited a court of appeal decision. The figures that were posed, and also while being guided by the authority that was cited, the court will agree that the proposed fine is within the fine ranges of this court. The court has taken into account the ages of both accused person and the circumstances under which the offence was committed.
Na mtazamaji, kinachoendelea hapo ni kutolewa kwa hukumu dhidi ya mbunge wa Sirisia John Wavuke pamoja na Grace Wahungu katika sakata ya mahindi ya mwaka 2004. Kwa hivyo tutakuwa tukiwaletieni mengi tu kuhusiana na hayo ambayo atakuwa ametolewa katika hukumu hiyo katika taarifa zetu za mwendo wa saa 3, lakini kwa sasa tutakuwa tukiondoka studioni kupisha mazungumzo kuhusiana na masuala ya biashara za wastani na biashara ndogo ndogo na athari ambazo biashara hizi zimepata kutokana na COVID-19, katika mazungumzo ambayo atakuwa akiongoza mwenzangu Dan Mwangi kwa lugha ya kimombo katika Nation Leadership Forum. Kwa hivyo usiondoke, endelea kutazama kwa niaba yangu na wengine wote ambao wameshiriki kufanikisha NTV jioni. Tunasema shukrani katika lugha ishara. Tumekuwa naye David Agondoa, mimi ni Daniel Mule, na kutakia watazamaji mwema wa vipindi vyetu.
This is NTV.
Osha mikono, osha yako.
Osha mikono, osha yako.
Ikiwezekana fanyia kazi kwako. Hata Mungu muabudie kwako. Yuko kila pahali, hata kusikia.
Ombe ya wale imeshafika kwao. Ashinde kifo.
Nawe
jizuie. Ni kwa muda tu tutashinda.
Oya ni aje, mino jonte fresh. Mindo nimetambulika igi komba yote sekta ya manguo.
Jumio transform ordinary za mtush zenye ziuka mna ya rufu ya bale into the freshest igikos yote.
Siri ni hii Ariel mpya ya
sana na history. Ninatumia Ariel Touch of Downy mpya tu.
Like every mother, I'm worried about dangerous insects, especially mosquitoes, which spread diseases like malaria to my loved ones. This year, I'm not afraid. I'm using Mortine Doom. Mortine Doom All Insect Killer provides protection in seconds. Not even a single mosquito is spared, because even one mosquito bite can cause malaria. Mortine Doom provides protection in seconds.
We all are looking for products to protect ourselves from viruses, but not all products protect us. Did you know that using Dettol soap and water protects against viruses? Many viruses are surrounded by an envelope with receptors that enable them to enter a human cell and cause infection. Dettol soap destroys the outer layer of the virus and effectively removes it. Protect your family from the spread of viruses with Dettol. Dettol cleans and is now tested and proven to be effective against COVID-19 virus. This has been Medifacts for Dettol.
My whole life is in my phone.
I help women find independence by training them in fish farming. It's tough on my back, joints, and can cause headaches. Panadol Extra relieves multiple types of pain. Panadol Extra, now with new OptiZob technology. To fight multiple tough pains, with three times more pain-relieving medicine in the first 30 minutes when you need it most. Seeing them support themselves makes any pain worth it. If symptoms persist, seek medical advice.
Wa Kenya, hii fight hatukuchagua, lakini tuko na choice. Tuchague kujilinda. Tuchague kuprotect familia zetu. Tuchague usafi. Kuosha mikono. Kuosha manyumba zetu. Ndiyo tulinde watoto wetu. Na tuvae mask. Future yetu iko mikononi mwetu. Kenya, let's do it for the ones we love.
He was by far the most renowned Luhya leader of his time. Not only did he hold sway over politics in Western Province, but during his time as Secretary General of the ruling Kenya African National Union, KANU, he was the second most powerful man in the party, if not in the country. Moses Budamba Mudavadi was born in humble surroundings in Vihiga location of the then Kakamega district. Mudavadi married Hannah Asianzale, with whom he would have six children. Their last born, Wycliffe Musalia, would later serve a stint as Kenya's eighth vice president before going on to become a deputy prime minister.
This is Fact Finder from the BBC.
We look at Russia's renewed relations with Africa and what's in it for the continent.
The wedding that never was. We look at how Nigerians fell for a fake alert on a clandestine wedding allegedly involving President Muhammadu Buhari.
We find out why you need to be cautious about what you publish online.
Saizi kupimwa HIV ni haraka na ni bure. Unaweza pimwa kwa clinic na bado unaweza jipimia kwa nyumba yako wewe mwenyewe na self test kit 500 peke yake. Uko na HIV si eti ni mwisho.
Wewe uko nayo?
Mimi nilishapima.
Afya bora, maisha bora. Jipime, jinue.
Change can be disruptive, but Business Daily has got you covered from Monday to Friday. Get evolving trends, ingenious business ideas, and the latest tech content in the new market dynamic and exciting lifestyle content in the new normal environment. Business Daily, more possibilities.
encrypted with grace.
I wasn't ready to be a family man. I was breaking people more than I was building them.
Fathering is not something perfect men do, but something that perfects the man, by Frank Pittman. We're celebrating dads through the month. In one way or another, we have special guests coming on the show, and today's guest is no exception.
You lost your wife and your baby was only 3 months old, so you had to play the role of mom and dad.
The day she passed, I asked God, really? So here I am, being all the man that I possibly can, and you take her away from me. How is this possible?
Join Grace Msalami this Saturday from 8 p.m.
Tomorrow, I go on a breakfast date. We hold a blind date and we show you the new normal of restaurants and show you how dates will actually look like in the near future. So catch me on this date tomorrow after the workout at 6:30 in the morning here on NTV.
This is NTV.
It is the 25th day of June 2020. It's just a bit over 100 days into the COVID-19 pandemic situation in the country, and the effects have been felt far and wide, and they have cost people jobs, and that is livelihoods, and the disease itself has actually cost us lives, unfortunately. But we still have to soldier on, and we're going to be having a discussion in light of the COVID-19 pandemic's effect and the related measures on the SME sector, that is the MSMEs and the SMEs, that's the small and medium-sized enterprises, as well as the micro size medium enterprise on today's Nation Leadership Forum. Thanks for joining us. My name is Dan Mwangi, and I'm going to be introducing my panel in just a bit. But first, just to get some context into this conversation with a bit of data, first and foremost, we have the in terms of the impact of the pandemic, and this is an Ipsos report, which is on how COVID-19 pandemic is affecting small businesses. Those that have had significant negative impact, there's 76% of SMEs who are polled, and that is more than three quarters of the SMEs. Those who have experienced minimal negative impact are 18%. Positive impact to some elements is 5%. And those who have felt no impact on their businesses are at 1%. And so we could see the majority are significantly hit. And the most affected sectors, these are who have seen over 70% impact on their business, that's in transport and logistics, tourism and hospitality, leisure, sports, art and creative sector. We have education as well, agriculture, trade and manufacturing, and real estate. And those who've had some moderate to low impact, that is mining and construction, manufacturing and energy. And we have those who have had none or some positive impact, that's ICT, finance and insurance, as well as health. And so these are some of the statistics that we'll be using to have our discussion this evening. And I'm joined by a panel of four, two gentlemen and two ladies. We are very good with our balance of gender. We are grateful for that. And first and foremost, we have Betty Miner, who's the Cabinet Secretary of Industrialization and Enterprise Development. We also have Linus Gitahi, who is the Chairman of Diamond Trust Bank. And we have Caroline Gerch, who is the Country Director of Amani Institute, Kenya. And last but not least, we have the other gentleman, that's Richard Ngatia, who is the president of the Kenya National Chamber of Commerce and Industry. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us and welcome to this edition of the Nation Leadership Forum. And we'll ask you to just chime into the conversations using the hashtag NMG Leadership Forum, and let's have the conversations online as well as the discussion on air. So I want to begin with you, Madam CS, first and foremost. This is an ever-changing situation. The situation we were in on day one is not the same as day two, not the same as day 30, 50, 100, and today we are over day 100. What is the current situation in regards to SMEs? Are we already seeing some sort of light at the end of the tunnel, or are we still, like the infections, are still getting into that peak?
Thank you very much, and I'm happy to join you today. I hope you can hear me.
Yes, we can.
Good. Thanks very much. I think we are all living with COVID now. The last time we appeared on this program, it was early days yet, and we thought it was something that would last maybe 2-3 months. I think now we are getting ourselves accustomed to the fact that we shall be living with COVID for a long time until a vaccine is found and until as many people as need to be vaccinated or become immune. It's been a great impact on businesses of all kinds. In the beginning, it was mostly, we thought, affected people who are exposed to the global supply chains, i.e. exporters and those who relied on imported raw materials. But with the onset of a lot of the restriction measures that government has had to put in place to manage transition, it has affected many people. And we confirmed the statistics from Ipsos consistent with the statistics from the surveys by the ministry itself that says that the ones who are most affected are either those who are exposed to external travel and especially in the tourism sector and transport and logistics in that sector, or the ones who are in, you know, in food production, especially when there was restriction on restaurants and eateries and other such places. Now, if we hadn't taken those measures, and I think it is clear that we first appreciate, if government hadn't taken those measures, the health impact would have been even greater than what we have now. We have a bit under 5,500 cases at present. Unfortunately, it's still rising because of the community transmission that has been established. With regard to the impact on small businesses, we acknowledge that to be the case. And one of the things that government has been doing since the beginning, from all the measures the president has announced, has been an intention to try and cushion small businesses. It's not been enough, but it's been better than nothing. I think what the central bank did with regard to credit terms has made a difference, and I'm glad to see Linus is on the call. DTB is a big banker of SMEs, and they've had to reorganize their facilities significantly in order to support businesses. Secondly, a lot of businesses haven't been closed. Government was careful not to close many businesses, but they have obviously performed or operated at lower capacity than they had intended to because of the shortage of demand. When we have social distancing and less people going into the city center, for instance, it affected some retail outlets because they just don't have the normal clients that they would have. But they have soldiered on, and I'm excited by those who have continued to maintain a modicum of operations. The government actions with regard to payment, for instance, of pending bills, has ensured that there's at least a bit of liquidity. We prioritized small bills, which are mostly associated with small businesses, and that has assisted quite a bit in reducing the impact. But many businesses have also adjusted. I'm also glad to note from your surveys from Ipsos that small businesses in ICT, for instance, or in delivery services, have readjusted themselves, and we see them thriving in this regard. So it's been a mixed bag.
Okay.
And it shall continue to be a mixed bag as we continue to live with COVID. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Madam CS. And I want to bring in Linus, as you mentioned him, and Linus, Diamond Trust Bank, being a financier, one of the things that the poll shows, and which is not only this one but also other polls, indicate that there are fewer number of customers who are applying for loans or servicing their current loans as a result of loss or decline in income. Now, between the beginning of the situation and now, are we seeing any kind of change in the, you know, the borrowing habits of people? Are we seeing people having an increasing affinity as we start seeing things looking like they will get better?
Well, thank you very much. Thank you very much, Dan. Very happy to be in the panel with Waziri. And I think we are lucky to have Waziri being in charge of trade and industrialization, because Waziri has been involved and has been in the private sector for most of our life. So I think COVID found us with the right Waziri, and we thank you for all the initiatives that you're taking. Talking about the bank, Diamond Trust Bank, as you have said, is a bank that thrives and prides itself as a bank that supports SMEs. It's a Kenyan bank, it's one of the oldest banks in the country, and one of the things that we really do very, very well is manage and work together with SMEs. Now, obviously, this pandemic has affected most of the SMEs. I'll be the first to agree with the Ipsos statistics. And I want to say at the outset that DTB has been on the forefront of helping to rearrange and to work with the customers one-on-one and look at the various needs, so that where we need to do a little bit of restructuring, we've been on the forefront of doing that, because we have a very, very close relationship with our customers. But one of the things that will emerge as we go along is that the restructuring, while as it gives you some breathing space, it's not really the solution, because the problem that SMEs are having today is, it's maybe threefold. The first one is reduced demand. Reduced demand because of what is happening in the economy, and that reduced demand is something that we as a country, as a people, as a ministry, need to address. And that reduced demand is also linked to the whole area of labor, the cost of labor. So SMEs are actually caught between a rock and a hard place, because they are actually the biggest employers in this country. And when they are forced to retrench, and many of them, to be honest, I think the same survey does talk about it, they've tried to stretch as much as possible. They've tried to stretch not to retrench people, but the cost of labor in their P&L is becoming significant and in some cases unbearable. I talked about the cost of credit, that is, the restructuring is happening, but that in a sense just delays the fact that money will still need to be paid. So whereas we have seen reduced demand, I must say that we've also seen in many instances resilience on the part of the SMEs. And I think what we really need to do, and I know the government has started doing that, is to find ways of even increasing the stimulus that the government has been doing, because let us not forget that those SMEs, being the major employers in a country where employment was already a problem. So we can ill afford to put more people into unemployment, and therefore we must, and I'm glad we're having this conversation, look for even more ways and means of ensuring that the SMEs continue employing people. And that speaks to different stimulus opportunities that maybe you're going to discuss in the course of this program.
All right. Thank you very much, Bwana Gitahi. And now to bring in Richard Ngatia now. And Bwana Gitahi has also mentioned about the issues of jobs and the likes. And the survey as well speaks of those 27% of the SMEs have chosen to take flexible working patterns, such as working from home. And, you know, some have taken no contingency measures, that's 18%. And others are looking for alternative or new supply chains. Bwana Ngatia, when you think about the situation as it is, and, we, you know, again, Linus has mentioned that there are some stimulus packages that have been given, do you feel that these are enough to ensure that these very jobs, for instance, are not lost further, and that we can create new jobs? Do you feel we still need, there's still more that needs to be done to ensure that that the SMEs can still be sustainable going forward?
Yes, thank you very much, Dan. And I want to thank Nation Media Group for having us. And, you know, it's very good that we are still continuing with the partnership. I remember the last time when we had a very successful conference at the KICC in a bid to reach out to the public and also the private sector, so that we can engage and have a conversation with them. And, of course, I'm very excited to see CS Betty. It has been a long day for us. I know we were still in another meeting for long hours, and to see Gitahi, Caroline. So thank you very much for that. Now, it is important to see how SMEs can be supported, how SMEs can be plugged in into making sure that there's financial inclusion, how there can be a relief on SMEs during this pandemic and the COVID-19. First of all, we have seen Central Bank of Kenya give physical measures on credit management policies, which include economic stimulus program, as you mentioned. We have seen they have given that program to a tune of 3 billion shillings. In my view, I think it will be very important to unpack and to the SMEs and tell them how exactly what this means, what the stimulus package means to them. One, we need to restructure of existing loans, and we have seen also the financial institutions, you know, according moratoriums to even up to 3 and 4 years to those who have existing loans. We have seen those payments again of moratoriums, as I'm saying. We have seen also opportunities for new loans and line of credit. But again, we need the same SMEs or the private sector. They need to go to the banks. They need to engage the banks and go and say, what are the problems they have? What are the credit facilities that they need? Now, the government, through economic stimulus, established SME credit guarantee scheme, and that is very important to come and revive the economy. Again, we need to look at grants and subsidies. We, as the Kenya National Chamber of Commerce, we are here to support the SMEs and the private sector to have a conducive environment to work in. We are here to partner with financial institutions. We are here to partner with the national government, county governments, so that we can see an all-inclusive and a win-win situation for our SMEs, and especially during this time. We need also to look at the survival mechanisms. How do these SMEs survive through these 3, 4, or 5 years? This is a long-term problem we have, and we need to adjust ourselves to the new normal. Thank you
very much. I'd like to bring in Caroline now. And Caroline, you deal a lot with the soft skills at the Money Institute. You know, when it comes to the training, innovation, and, you know, like some management consultancy. And this is a difficult time, for instance, for employers, even as they have to do the balance of their monies, for instance, and what they invest in. And this even now goes into investment in HR. What do you feel, what do you think employers should take into account? How do you think they should do this balance when they're trying to ensure that they don't, you know, drop the ball, especially where it comes to lives and livelihoods?
Yeah, thank you for that question. And I think it's a really important one. And before I go answering it, I want to really express my support for the points that were mentioned earlier, like the need for a stimulus package and the need for SMEs to have access to credit. When we go to the question about, you know, how do you as an SME owner or as a management team trying to balance, or what we call navigate a polarity, right? So cash is already a very precious commodity as it is, and now to invest in staff development seems something that a lot of SMEs might be hesitant to do at the first place. However, there are ways to invest in the continuous development of your staff in a way that it doesn't break the bank. So that's one of the things that when we work with our existing clients, we also we give them hints on how they can do staff development at a very low cost, so that we know that if the budgets are not huge, they can still go ahead and invest in their employees. And why should you invest? It's not just, a lot of SMEs think it's for motivational reasons. We at Amani, we know that businesses who want to stay competitive, they must invest in their employees in order to remain or gain competitiveness. And it's even more important right now. One thing that we've maybe not talked about as part of this conversation yet is that a lot of SMEs had to change either their business model altogether, or they had to adjust their operating model. And when you do that, you also need to train your staff in the new skills that are required to execute that new business model. It doesn't go without it. So I would always now think that if you're one of the SMEs that is adjusting to this pandemic by actually trying to see new values of or new ways to create value for customers, that could be through new products, through new services, through new avenues and channels, then you need to ensure that your staff has the skills to execute.
Thank you very much, Caroline. And that is a good place to end the first part of this show. We'll be having a lot more. We've got two more parts of this to go on and just to have a discussion into the different opportunities that are there for SMEs, how they should prepare themselves and how to access the markets that they desire after this break.
Your gums hurt?
Yeah.
Does your toothpaste contain sage, eucalyptus, myrrh, chamomile?
All that in one toothpaste?
Yes, try Colgate Herbal. Colgate Herbal contains nature's best herbs and Colgate's fluoride technology to give you strong teeth and healthy gums.
Ah, Colgate Herbal.
Let's go. Colgate Herbal for strong teeth and healthy gums naturally.
Explorers of the night, wale wasi wa kuhasulu siku, kustreama movies, music mix diehards, and gaming fanatics. We've heard you. It is now your time to fly your flag high. Do what you love, mpaka che na Telkom. Join Usiku Sako with Telkom night bundles that allow you rule the night at prices you love. Join our tribe, Usiku Sako Squad. Just dial *544# from your Telkom line and select the night bundle of your dreams. You are the legend. The night needs.
For a better tomorrow, don't forget to do the 1-2-3 with Colgate every night. Smile through your day with
a fresh breath and strong teeth. Disinfect and protect your home with JIC. JIC kills 99.9% of illness-causing germs. Disinfect floors, kitchen and bathroom surfaces and wash white clothes, towels and dishcloths with JIC bleach. Just JIC it.
We want you to relax and feel safe in your own home, at the office, in a restaurant, at the salon, or any public space that you visit. Ace Cleaning products are a sure way of feeling safe and secure in your home.
Welcome back to the Nation Leadership Forum, and today's edition we're speaking about SMEs, and we're seeing a lot of activity on the digital space. There's a significant shift as well as some of the challenges and opportunities that are there, and I still have my panel with me, and I'll go to CS Betty Miner now. And you know, since the beginning of this situation in Kenya, we've seen different businesses, SMEs especially, beg your pardon, who are coming up with different products. You are seeing masks are being made locally, PPEs, a lot of the PPEs, and actually CS Mutahi Kagwe said that we'll no longer be importing. And there's a lot that is being done. There's a lot of local production as we push the Buy Kenya, Build Kenya. So in light of this, in your own estimation, how much is this going to affect our imports? Because just to see whether we can reduce the imports, are we seeing any kind of percentage of imports being dropped even post the pandemic?
I would like to do that. I would like to see more import substitution by Kenyans. And I think one of the things that we've really enjoyed, and it's been very energizing in this last 3 months, is to see the amount of latent capacity that we've always had in Kenya. And it's actually an indictment on us that we have over-glorified and imported products to the detriment of our own capability. And I think this innovativeness that we've seen in Kenya, it was a result, it was a reaction to the supply chain disruptions globally and the challenge that most of us see on China. And I'm very proud. I think the example that you've given is the example of Mercy, something that has been, you know, very widespread around the country, and little businesses have given themselves a lifeline by producing these goods. But I'm also excited by the fact that we are able to now produce the personal protective equipment that we need to almost all wholly import in the past. But the Ministry of Health is buying from local sources, and we're very excited by that. I'm excited about the work that is happening, especially around ventilators. We have unveiled to the public various prototypes over the last 2 months. But now those prototypes are actually ready and going up for clinical trials. So that would mean that in future, we can produce these things in Kenya. And we will not just be producing for Kenya, we'll be producing for the regional market and other markets. And it will be an exciting moment for Kenya. When we first spoke about this crisis, we said and we challenged ourselves to look at the opportunities it has presented. And I think those opportunities for local manufacturing are exciting. The opportunities for digital businesses, the stuff that is now happening and all the work around, you know, delivery services and digitally enabled supply services are things that will stay with us. And I think will be the new business models going ahead. Thank you very much.
All right, I just want to find out from you, do you feel that we needed a pandemic to take such significant steps in supporting local manufacturing?
No, we didn't. But I think when we look back in future, I think we will be happy that we took the opportunity of this crisis to resolve some structural challenges. Every crisis has a silver lining. Well, I think the saying goes, if the world gives you lemon, make lemonade. So I think it's clear that Kenya and Kenyan businesses has chosen to make lemonade out of this crisis.
Okay, I want to bring in Linus now. And Linus, we touched on the financial aspect of it, and right now people are still struggling with getting the money they would need. What options are there? And aside from money, there's also the aspect of training, which some may feel is going to be an additional cost. So then again, it again becomes another demand for resources. How can SMEs get the financing as well as opportunities for training to have quality products?
First of all, I think when we talk about financing, let's be very clear. The financing is available, and I think it is available not just in DTB, it's available across the chain. The issue with SMEs and finances is the cost of the finance, and cost of finance is a market dynamics thing. So one of the things, particularly during this pandemic, that maybe the government ought to look at is how we can, because it's really for a short time. SMEs actually don't require handouts. What they require is access to cheaper finance, particularly during this period when they are suffering. So the question is, how can we create a little buffer, like whether it is through some credit guarantee scheme or whether it is through actual funds put in to help bridge the gap between, let's say, the current price of, let's say, treasury bills, which influence ultimately the cost of credit. How can we help to create a little gap so that the SME is able to borrow at a slightly reduced number, and then the bank doesn't suffer because the bank is also in business. So there is opportunity for us to have a conversation with government, and I think that is something that is ongoing, to see how we maybe a small buffer can be created that enables the SME to access credit at a cheaper price. But it's not just about the government. I think this COVID, and in a sense, I agree with the CS, this COVID is also a challenge to SMEs. I think it is an opportunity for consolidation, and I'm very sure that we are going to see a lot of consolidation amongst SMEs. Quite frankly, I think the future multinationals are going to be created by this pandemic, because SMEs are going to come together and realize that actually the way we were doing business was not efficient, and probably talking to the guy next door and coming together to create a bigger organization probably offers a better opportunity for businesses. You know, if you look at transport, in the past we've been seeing, let's say, 14-seater matatos carrying 20 people. I don't think we're going to go to that situation again, not just because the whole thing about social distance is something that people are going to take more seriously, but also because it is the right thing to do for people to travel in comfort. In order to achieve that, I think we are going to see consolidation in many different businesses, whether it is restaurants, whether it is whether it is transport, etc., etc. But I also want to say, the real issue also that is tied to the cost is the issue of demand, and this is an area that, because it's a global pandemic, I actually think, and it's already happening in Europe, in the US, people are beginning to look inwards and saying, for this period, how am I going to protect my business? How is the government going to protect the businesses, even from external competition? Because, you know, toothpicks from China are going to continue being cheaper. But how can you enable this business that is already having a cash flow problem, and it is making toothpicks, be protected for a while so that it can actually recoup? And I think that is a conversation. Whereas blanket protection of industry is not something that I would encourage, because we need to create competition. But we are in a very unique situation where governments need to look inwards and see what it is we need to do to protect the businesses and help to put them back in a competitive situation. So that is another way of actually helping to fund businesses, by ensuring that we give them a greater market through a bit of protection from external competition for a short time.
Okay, thank you very much. And just as a small side note, which is a significant one, is that we have some breaking news that Sirisia MP John Waluke has been ordered to pay a fine of over 600 million shillings, and he should serve a jail term of 7 years if he defaults on payment of the millions of shillings he has. And this is in a case regarding some corruption with the National Cereals and Produce Board, which was about over 300 million shillings. And this is the MP and two others have been found guilty, were found guilty of defrauding NCPB. And again, I repeat, he has been sentenced to 7 years in prison if he does not pay the fine of over 600 million shillings. That is Sirisia MP John Waluke, which again just points to the concerns about corruption, because even in his submissions and his lawyer submissions, he was not an MP then, he was just a business person. And so we come back to the discussion on the National Leadership Forum, that you know, when I think about this kind of case of corruption, Bwanangatia, and you think about the fact that some of the SMEs miss out on opportunities in regards to this, We actually have a concern. What are we doing to ensure, like for yourself as KNCCI, that we can have SMEs operating above board in terms of integrity and the likes? Because we don't want, you know, the COVID pandemic has granted an opportunity for us to change things. So how do we ensure that we have people who are operating upright?
Okay, thank you very much, Dan, for that question. We, as the chamber, Again, like I said, we are making sure that we protect businesses of SMEs. And by doing so, we also engage them and capacity build them, one on, like you said, integrity, ethics, and also corporate governance. So those are the areas that they must know what to do so that they are not caught up in these situations. The other thing we also try to encourage them is to make sure that as they conduct their businesses, they must then be able to get certain advice from their legal advisors, legal departments. If not, we as the chamber are there. And looking at that, once then you have put your systems in place, then you will look at opportunities. Mainly you look at, for example, e-commerce and online sales. You look at digital education. These are areas that we come to support in terms of educating them, so that also as you look at the issues of ethics and integrity is observed. Having said that, I also want to look at how do we support SMEs as they get out of that and as they also enhance their businesses. One, we look at opportunities that are available. Every challenge, I heard that you've asked whether this, you've asked a question on the challenge that we are having now. But remember, every challenge comes with opportunities. And we want to look at how do we support our youth in business? How do we support women in business? We want to look at financial technology. You have raised issues on finance, how to be able to get this, you know, how to be included in financial inclusion. So we want to look at financial products. We want to engage banks so that they can come with relaxed products that SMEs or even MSMEs can be able to understand and go on. We want to look at digital health, for example. When you look at digital health, we are talking of many areas. We are talking of e-health, we are talking of telemedicine, and we are talking of many other areas. We want to look at support for local manufacturing that has been mentioned earlier. And this is a good thing because, again, you're giving, like the CS said, you're giving a lifeline to SMEs. This does not necessarily come to stop businesses for those who are exporting. Again, like I said, there are more and more opportunities. Remember, as the African Continental Free Trade Area opens up, those are opportunities, and this is about 1.2, 1.3 billion you know, customers that you may have. And so we need to embrace innovation, we need to embrace e-commerce, and also we need to educate our youth and even the startups and even those in the universities on corporate governance, ethics, and yes, and ethics. So again, Dan, that is what I would say, I'd want to say for now.
Okay, thank you very much. I want to bring in Caroline, and one of the things that some of these SMEs are having to deal with is access to markets, because some of them, you can find their distribution channels have been cut short. We're seeing even the studies are saying that one of the biggest things is lower demand, as well as another one is access to markets. So what opportunities do, you know, the SMEs have in terms of accessing new markets, and how can they?
Thanks for that question, Dan. I think it really depends what industry you're in, right? If you are in a technology-enabled industry, you probably have an easier time to find also markets elsewhere. So the digital economy was mentioned already by a few people. I think really also looking, if we were serving the Kenyan or market primarily as an SME, maybe we can go regional or we can go global. I mean, we have fantastic technology startups and SMEs in this country, and they can be the driving force for finding new markets. And if there is a lot of innovation, someone mentioned innovation earlier, and I think that is really the way how to get to new markets. Is the route is through innovation and through value addition. Kenya as a country has huge potential for in a lot of fields to do extra value addition, which then give new markets. And that really, that agenda should be driven not just by the SMEs themselves trying to look for market elsewhere, but this is really an effort where multiple players need to come together to give those SMEs a chance to find new markets. But I also want to say that from everything that we are seeing from peers, from clients, from people we are working with, is that everyone is trying. I really want to say that I'm really inspired how the people that we work with, the SMEs that we see, they're really trying to innovate. They're trying to find new markets. So I'm just going to give an example. There is an SME that was in the event management space. And as you know, events right now, the demand is really low. And so they really had to ask themselves the hard question. So if we want to survive, so then how do we make sure that we innovate? And so then now they set up a digital event management company. And so now they moved themselves out of Kenya, because previously they were really focusing on the Kenyan market. Now that they've opened up to the digital space, then they can serve customers elsewhere. I do recognize it really is industry specific how you find new customers, but the question really is asking yourself, if I was serving a particular customer segment earlier, how can I find a new one? So if I was focusing on, let's say, middle income customers, maybe I can go down to or up a tier and I say, oh, why don't I make a product that will serve also customers with lower incomes. So I think it really depends on the SME. But one thing I know is that if you do that questioning, and this is really a leadership and management question, right? Each SME right now has to juggle a lot of balls. We need to keep the lights on, and it's really hard. us being an SME ourselves, trying to keep the lights on, trying to keep people on payroll, trying to come up with innovative solutions so that people can have a job, and that when demand picks back up, there is a business that is ready to do that. And whilst we are doing that, we are still innovating. So okay. I want to really also say that there is fantastic work that is being done by Kenyan SMEs. And I know that if more of SMEs are jumping on that bandwagon, we can come out of this stronger.
Thank you very much. I want to bring in the CS on this as well, because one of the things that Caroline has actually mentioned is just about the access, and is the online access to markets. It's giving a new platform. We have seen a lot of activity. E-commerce has gone up and the likes. But we have the small businesses that are in areas that may not have as good access to internet, for instance, or where, you know, access to internet is not a thing that is a big thing to them. How are we then trying to ensure that they can also have a fair playing field? Madam CS, can you hear me?
I have to repeat, unfortunately. Oh, I lost.
No problem. No problem. I'm just saying that we've seen that there's a lot of opportunities coming up in terms of marketing, for access to market online. We are seeing many people, you know, have increased e-commerce transactions and advertising. But aside from that, we have those who may be in places where internet access is a challenge, or those who may not be very big on the internet. How do we help them? How do we help them to ensure that they also have a level playing field, that they can also have you know, access to market?
Okay, thanks very much. I hope I got it. I think it's a question around e-commerce and internet access and equity.
Yes.
Of the same. I think two things. Obviously the country is very different, and internet access is very different across the country, so we appreciate that. But to improve on that, one of the things that was an initial announcement during this COVID crisis was the announcement of availability of the Loon technology and the use of these lunar balloons that would be able to help us with expansion of internet access in the country. So I think we're now dealing with issues of coverage. But that has also been, you know, a program within government to be able to expand internet access. But not everybody is internet savvy. So I think we also need to appreciate that the role, I think there are different roles. And for those people who can probably work in networks with those who are internet savvy and be able to get into bulking and bulking houses and, at least people who do congregation of various products and accumulation, that can help with the internet and the e-commerce reach. Because one of the things that we've struggled with is once you put your product on a platform, you need to be certain that there is sufficient supply. You cannot just go and put, 100 beads and or 100 items of whichever, whichever dimension that you require, because the internet and the e-commerce platform avails a market for, a million, 2 million plus in any given day. So we actually need to work with the chains that works on accumulation and congregation of various products. So it's possible, even if a business isn't online itself, it can be part of a chain that is part of an online platform. So the guys in Dagoretti Corner, for instance, or on Gong Road who do furniture, if they come together and have a collective, it is possible to have a display of their products. I think it is a creative way that we would work with them, and our Micro and Small Enterprises Authority is designed to work with giving these sort of services to small businesses. But others, I think Amani is giving that example. Other businesses can come up that actually can support small businesses reach a wider market through the online platforms.
Okay, and we may take a break, but Madam Sias, just for 10 seconds, you've mentioned the loon technology. Are the balloons, are we already benefiting from them? Is there already a group of people that are accessing internet on account of the loon balloons?
Yes, because this has been available in the country for now nearly 8 weeks. And it's a service that's provided in partnership with Telkom Kenya. So I think Telkom Kenya customers can tell us about their greater reach around the country. So this is something we're all quite excited as a methodology for expanding internet access in the country.
Okay, thank you very much, Madam Sias. I will be coming back with a bit more of the conversation after this as we look to getting some commitments and just some more insight in regards to the SMEs, the pandemic, and beyond. Stay tuned.
Jonte Fresh, mimi ndio nimetambulika hii Gikomba yote sekta ya manguo.
Jumio transform nguo ordinary za mtush zenye ziuka na hii harufu ya bale
into the freshest igi kosi yote. Siri ni hii Ariel mpya ya pink.
Na kushua mtush zinang'ara kung'ara kushinda kamera. So clean, so fresh. Ma customer unai sana na history.
Ninatumia Ariel Touch of Downy mpya tu.
We all are looking for products to protect ourselves from viruses, but not all products protect us. Did you know that using Dettol soap and water protects against viruses? Many viruses are surrounded by an envelope with receptors that enable them to enter a human cell and cause infection. Dettol soap destroys the outer layer of the virus and effectively removes it. Protect your family from the spread of viruses with Dettol. Dettol cleans and is now tested and proven to be effective against COVID-19 virus. This has been Medifacts for Dettol.
Ah, Helen Paul.
Hello, madam. Would you like to join us on this mission?
Yes, but how?
Just one question for you. How do you keep your toilet clean?
I use regular detergent and bleach for washing and removing yellow stains. I've been using it for years.
Oh, madam, the regular detergents and bleach are used for washing clothes. To disinfect your toilet properly, you need Harpic 10X. It is specially made for germs and stains removal. Harpic's thick formula settles on stains and gives 10 times better cleaning compared to regular detergents and bleach.
Wow, now I'm convinced, Helen Paul.
Really?
Yeah.
Now that she's part of the mission, the next house is yours.
The risk of illness-causing germs is increasing. It is believed that the coronavirus can remain on surfaces in your home for up to 9 days. Touching infected surfaces is one of the ways in which germs spread. Regularly disinfect your floors, countertops, and kitchen surfaces with bleach, and use an effective toilet cleaner inside and outside your toilet bowl. This message is brought to you by Medifacts, Jik, and Harpic.
This is NTV.
What makes a Kenyan dental mom powerful?
I encourage my kids to learn new things. And if they get hurt, I rely on the power of my Dettol's one capful. To fight germs, it's like my own first aid kit.
My family needs protection from germs. I use the power of Dettol's one capful to disinfect surfaces and clothes to keep them clean and safe from germs.
I trust the power of Dettol's one capful for bathing. The power of Dettol's one capful protects from up to 100 illness-causing germs.
Dettol, Kenya's number one antiseptic for fighting germs. Become a powerful Kenyan mom with Dettol. Be 100% sure.
You in the pollution? Yes, you. Dry throat? Strepsils. Gal in the smoke with a raspy voice? Strepsils. Hello, in the downpour with a scratchy throat? Take Strepsils. Get soothing relief for any throat irritation. Strepsils, with its medicinal ingredients, will heal the harm done to your throat from external factors. Strepsils. Strepsils, for a dry, itchy, raspy, scratchy throat.
The risk of illness-causing germs is increasing. It is believed that the coronavirus can remain on surfaces in your home for up to 9 days. Touching infected surfaces is one of the ways in which germs spread. Regularly disinfect your floors, countertops, and kitchen surfaces with bleach, and use an effective toilet cleaner inside and outside your toilet bowl. This message is brought to you by Medifacts, Jik, and Harpic.
Whole life is in my phone.
Blue band margarine. New look, same great taste.
Wa Kenya, hii fight hatukuchagua, lakini tuko na choice. Tuchague kujilinda. Tuchague kuprotect familia zetu. Tuchague usafi. Kuosha mikono. Kuosha manyumba zetu. Ndiyo tulinde watoto wetu. Na tuvae mask. Future yetu kwa mikononi mwetu. Kenya, let's do it for the ones we love.
This is NTV.
Tonight,
today when you look at him, he's a broken man.
Sirisia MP John Waluke begs for mercy. But the law begins its harvest in the maize scandal. And also tonight, it's another day of drama at the Nairobi County Assembly. We tell you what this one's all about. Plus, another one brutalized and killed in Nandi over a face mask. And the police reckon with a people's anger.
Tumechoka sana na tabia ya askari ya kutudhulumu na kutuua.
And also tonight, the army of intruders prowling the streets in the day and a police service unable to serve and protect. Want you to relax and feel safe in your own home, at the office, in a restaurant, at the salon, or any public space that you visit. Ace Cleaning products are a sure way of feeling safe and secure in your home.
Once again, welcome back to the Nation Leadership Forum. And like we said, we're talking about SMEs, the COVID-19 pandemic and beyond. And now let's start getting more into the beyond part, that when we talk about sustainability of the businesses and of the operations, and one of the things that the companies, the firms have been encouraged to do is to have sustainability plans and, you know, just business continuity plans, I beg your pardon. I want to bring in Bwanangatia on this one. Bwanangatia, when it comes to business continuity, what do these SMEs need to do such that if there's someone who has an SME now and feels that they are not too sure of the way forward, what do they need to do to ensure that they've got a proper plan that is going to be sustainable so that you don't start pumping resources into something that is not sustainable?
Okay, thank you very much, Dan. I think looking at the situation now and SMEs, and how probably they can be able to recover from the current situation, I would want to, in my view, look at, you know, as a business support institution, since the outbreak of COVID-19, we have given various proposals as the chamber and measures to support SMEs. Have, you know, business continuity and survival moving forward as follows. One is training on government guidelines and protocols. That is very important. Number two, we are talking of business re-engineering and restructuring. We also want to look at dissemination of relevant information from all the stakeholders, you know, across the country. And then we as the chamber have partnered with financial institutions to provide liquidity and cash flow support services. Various development partners have come to support us so that we can also see the SMEs, those in retail, and namely the partners that who we are working very, very closely with. For example, the Swedish government, under that is FSD, this is the finance sector deepening. They are supporting the retailers to by guaranteeing them so that they can be able to get commodities from manufacturers and they can be able to sell at a good time, and also as they get paid. We are also in partnership with other financial institutions whereby they are looking at providing, you know, providing finance and not actually even asking for collateral. Again, we are looking at those, for example, in the transport sector, we are looking at the those in manufacturing industry, for example, the Juakali sector, where we know they are 18.1, but we are also concentrating much on the artisans so that they can be, we can be able to support them with the products that they are able to manufacture. So therefore, we are able, through the partnerships we have with these financial institutions, to support them access finance and of course finance that is readily available. Over and above that, we are also in partnership with development partners, supporting them in terms of capacity building. We make sure we capacity build them on financial literacy. We make sure that they understand the market. We prepare them and for readiness of market. We also established business recovery support service through continuous information and guidelines on operations with business during this time of COVID. So therefore, we have developed an industry-specific sector business protocol for preparation and guidelines. So in terms of, yes, how we can be able to support and how what you're doing in terms of supporting these SMEs during this time is to make sure that they access finance, they access adequate education in terms of capacity building them, and not forgetting markets, which is very critical to any private sector member. You need your market, you need a steady market, and also we need to make sure that they observe specifications required by their customers so that they can be able to sell their products easily. So those are areas that we as the Kenya National Chamber are engaging, and with the help of the National Governing Council and my board, we are able to reach out to all SMEs in this country across all the 47 counties, and in partnership with the county governments as well, we are able to look at how they can be able to sustain their businesses by not and especially during this time, not paying so many multiple licenses. So those are areas we are focusing and looking at so that as we support the businesses. Dan.
When we still talk about sustainability and plans and going forward, I want to bring in Caroline again. And sub companies, many of them, like has been mentioned even before, will need to just rethink their whole model. You know, it's a time to reinvent themselves. What exactly do you feel are some of the pointers they need to take home to ensure that it's a successful, you know, reinvention?
Thanks, Dan, for that question. I think the first thing on the journey of reinvention is critically asking yourself, what do I need to unlearn as a business? Because we have had a way to serve our customers. We have had a way of working. We had a way of operating. And we really know that old way really well. And we might have fallen in love with it. And so unlearning a few things, even for Amani, we had to unlearn a few points when we had to move from an in-person delivery model of programming and giving trainings to an online delivery. We also had to unlearn a few things. And I think once you are ready to unlearn, then one other pointer is really asking yourself, what are the opportunities out there if I let go of a particular element of my way of operating or my business model? So I mentioned that a bit earlier. Maybe I have to go for a new customer segment. Maybe I'm inventing the product. Maybe I'm reinventing the delivery channel. There are a lot of resources out there on the internet for free for any business that they can go and see how can you reinvent your business model. And there are guiding questions. You just need internet access on your phone, and all these powerful questions are there. But then I think the proof of the pudding comes, can you sit together with your leadership team, with your staff, and really come up with a new product, with a new way of working? And then testing, right? One of the things we are very fond of when we work with our clients is prototyping, right? So you have to go out and find out what do customers want. You have to speak to them. You have to really understand that new market better. How can you serve them? And the beauty is, right now, around the world, Kenya is not the only country going through this process. And so there is a lot of opportunity because the playing field is leveled to some extent because other companies at the same time also have to reinvent themselves. And I think it's the ones who are most agile, the ones that are willing to unlearn a few things and be very quick in learning new things. These will be the successful SMEs coming out of Kenya and then not just serving Kenyans, but serving the region and serving a global audience.
Thank you very much. Very well spoken. And I want to bring in Lenas Gitahi here. And she's spoken about unlearning and some changes that will be inevitable, especially in light of the new rules. And Linus, I know you're also in manufacturing, and so maybe I would like to just, you know, pick your brain on this. We've got the new measures such as the social, or they say now physical distancing and the likes, yet some of our factories, which are some of the biggest employers in terms of mass in numbers, are not designed that much to accommodate that kind of thing. So what do you think, you know, companies need to do to ensure that they can still, what do you think they need to do now to ensure that they can still abide by the new rules, the new norm, and still remain, you know, in business and still not have to lose many people in terms of job losses?
Thank you very much for that question. First of all, before we went on break, we were talking about access to markets, and we were also talking about cost of credit. Maybe I should just take this opportunity to say that at Diamond Trust Bank, we actually do have platforms which are free and which we talk to our SMEs about, where you can actually have opportunities to showcase your products. We have platforms that can help you make payments. We have platforms that can help you collect payments. And those are broadly free, and we would encourage the SMEs and other parties to actually get in touch with our branches. We do go around the country talking about them so that they can see how they can benefit. Now, coming back to manufacturing, and really not even manufacturing, businesses, I agree that COVID is giving us an opportunity to really look at new ways of doing business. I'm not sure it's so much about unlearning as it is about adding learning on top of learning. Because sometimes we may complicate things, but for a business, it is sales less the cost, which gives you your gross profit. You remove expenses, it gives you your net profit. So those four elements are the ones that you're talking about when people are talking about re-engineering business. Not in the, there is nothing else. So when it comes to sales, you need to think about route to market, and that is why we're now talking about e-commerce platforms. How are your products getting to the consumer? Is that the most efficient way? Are there other ways? And in fact, are there opportunities for us even working with competition so that we can reduce the cost of getting the product across to the consumer? What about the cost? And for SMEs particularly, they need a lot of information about where you can get the various raw materials, because oftentimes an SME could be making product with raw materials that are probably more expensive than it ought to be, and probably just across the ridge or across in the next neighboring country are raw materials that can actually make you have a better margin. What about the expenses? With the advent of technology, are we actually using technology but still clinging to the old ways and incurring the lots of expenses that could be avoided? So I think this is what is being challenged by COVID, in the sense that because of not just reduced demand, but because of what you've talked about in terms of the fact that things like social distancing are actually here to stay, we need to look at new ways of operating in organizations. We actually need to re-engineer and ensure that the waste levels in businesses, and I think in SMEs the waste levels are generally higher because of inability to get into very modern technologies. But we've got opportunity now to actually ensure that we look at all those elements to reduce the cost of doing business. Right. The other thing I would want to add is that, and we talked about it earlier, is this thing about Buy Kenya, Build Kenya has been a song for a while. And I think, to be honest, His Excellency the President has talked about it a couple of times, about government buying local products. I think we just need to ensure, and I'm sure CS would have a view on this, we just need to ensure that we ruthlessly execute it. Hakuna mtu mwingine atatoka kwingine to support our businesses. We must ensure that we ourselves, starting with our government, starting with ourselves, buy these products from our SMEs because that's the easiest way of creating demand. And I think we kind of just need to be ruthless about it and ensure, particularly the government, is consuming exclusively from locally made products, because That's really one sure way of ensuring that we show up demand.
All right, thank you very much. I want to bring the CS there where he's mentioned about, you know, buy Kenya, build Kenya, and let's, you know, ruthlessly make it happen. And one of the concerns, for instance, is with second-hand clothes sellers, the mitumba, as we call them. And, you know, right now there is none of that. And it was, the ministry has said it's a temporary measure. But some feel that this is the ministry or the government silently trying to rule them out, yet they feel there's a possibility of coexistence. Is this the case? And when Linus talks about being ruthless, do you feel that's the way to go?
Thank you very much. It's a nice question. I think to clarify, the issue with regard to secondhand clothes is actually a standards enforcement question and issue, because the standard that has been adopted in Kenya prohibits importation of goods from countries experiencing pandemics. So the Bureau of Standards has applied that particular provision and given the advice to secondhand clothes dealers about that guidance. And I think, and we have given them feedback about how they can go around if they want to, you know, whatever proposals they have for dealing with the standard. It will obviously be dealt according to the provisions of the standard. But coming to the question on buy Kenya, build Kenya, it's been something I had from when I was a child. I mean, buy Kenya, build Kenya was always a clarion call of local businesses. And I'm glad that government has taken it up very much and has specific programs and targets for Buy Kenya, Build Kenya, including in the performance contracts of most government agencies. And we continue to implement that. There are still some challenges, and we are addressing that, because the entire regime for local content consumption needs to be a lot more robust and a lot more solid. And all of us in the public sector should do that. But I actually want to throw it back as well to the private sector, because the consumption of local goods is not the preserve of government alone. I am struck by the number of times that the private sector appeals to government to give them waivers on consumption of local goods with, you know, fairly flimsy arguments, which is the arguments we sometimes use of quality. So I think the challenge to all of us, and the challenge to all Kenyans, is to begin to build a different value and a different pride and dignity in consuming what we make in our country. Because the more we consume what we make in our country, the more we create jobs for ourselves and for, yeah, and especially for ourselves, and we're able to become a lot more sophisticated. They East African Customs Union, once it was first established in 2005,
okay,
has shown East Africans that you can produce these goods and they're of great quality, and they can, and you know, you solve a lot of problems. So I think the challenge goes to all of us. It is important to develop pride in our products and to be able to promote ourselves. And it is something we must all do. Thank you very much.
All right, Madam CS, just in closing and very briefly in 30 seconds, what commitment are you giving as the CS in charge of enterprise development and industrialization, trade as well, to the SMEs on the way forward in terms of support? What commitment are you giving, something tangible that they can actually hang on to, that it does not become another case of many promises but not much forthcoming?
I think there's a lot that the ministry and government has done to support SMEs during COVID and even before. And therefore, I think we want to give the commitment that the interests of SMEs will always be, in the front burner. Government will create the market for SME goods, as it has done through preferential procurement and the contracts it has given for small and medium businesses. Government will support with the financing. We're establishing a fund, and we're also working, because government doesn't have that much money.
Okay.
So we're working with the private sector in the establishment of the credit guarantee, which we hope can come into effect within this year. And that will be government's own support to leverage the resources within the private sector. The third thing that government is doing is provision of sites and infrastructure for small and medium businesses through a lot of, you know, whether it's dual Kali sheds or micro and enterprise sheds, but we are developing that, and we have actually, you know, we have a lot of the dual Kali sheds. I know we call them dual Kali sheds, but they actually, you know, that's government property, and we're working to ensure we improve the services in those areas. So what we can promise the businesses is that we will always remain open and listen to their proposals and turn them that into public policy. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And I just want to request my other panelists to take at max 30 seconds because we're talking about job losses. I don't want to be a statistic there. So I just bring a closing remark from, I'll begin with Linus Gitahi. What is your closing remark briefly, and any commitment as Diamond Trust Bank?
Very quickly, I'll say, you know, COVID has affected the whole world. Different governments in different countries are creating different stimulus for their businesses, for their people. I really, really, really look forward to looking back, and here I'm challenging the government, to really look at the best stimulus package that is going to give Kenya the best opportunity of competing post-COVID. I think that is a challenge that we have, and I really, really hope that we can look back and see that we had the best stimulus package for the size of our economy. And I have no doubt that with CSS like Betty, we would be we are very capable of doing that.
Thank
from
you.
A Diamond Trust Bank point of view, we will always, and we are working with our clients to ensure that whatever we can do to make them competitive, we continue to do. But like I said, it's not about credit, it's about cost of credit. And we need to work with all the stakeholders to ensure that that credit is affordable to our SMEs and MSMEs. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. You have overrun your time, but we shall discuss that afterwards. I want to talk to Ben Angatia, your closing remarks very briefly, and I feel yours should be in light of, for any SME that wants access to market and help, how can they get it, just so we can be clear.
Thank you very much. Looking at the chamber and under our pillars, we're saying we are there to support the our members. So I'm urging, and I'm taking this opportunity to urge those who are not yet our members to join so that they can benefit from the programs that we are actually rolling out from next week. We have two development partners who are already coming to support you in giving you grants, short grants, and they're giving you also loans for 6 months that will be a revolving fund. We have finance institutions that have come to support you where they were not going to ask for any collateral as long as you're a chamber member. So join us, but let's hold to our gains and let us adhere to the rules and guidelines of the Ministry of Health so that we stay safe.
Thank you very much. Caroline, in 20 seconds, kindly give us your closing remarks.
Yes, I think we can come out of this if we all partner across sectors. We're already starting to do this, and this panel being like an example of that. But if we want to come out as a stronger Kenya, now it's the moment that we need to embrace really cross-sector partnerships. And we as SMEs, we can do our part by talking to the different stakeholders and taking a seat at a table and then doing our best to serve Kenyans the best we know.
Thank you very much. I'd like to thank my panelists, Betty Miner, the CS for Industrialization and Enterprise Development, Linus Gitahi, who's the chairman of Diamond Trust Bank, Richard Ngatia, who's the president of the Kenyan National Chamber of Commerce and Industry, and Caroline Gerch, who is the country director of the Amani Institute Kenya. Thank you for joining us. Some of the learnings here are unlearn. Reach out, join hands, and let's work together to make Kenya better and stronger. Have yourselves a good evening. Thank you for joining us on National Leadership Forum. Smriti Vidyathi comes up with NTV tonight after this.
Beat sensitivity pain fast with Sensodyne Rapid Action for clinically proven relief in 60 seconds.
Malenge.
Sizile diyo ungetupatia kuriko hii.
Ile ni ya wageni wangu wanakuja.
Lazima tuchore anti. Bela lala. Lala.
Oi. Nini ni tena?
Liabu akifanya hivi, unampatia kitu tamu.
Selecta, bigger, tasty, and healthy.
And now Selecta comes with free Choco Primo drinking chocolate for a limited period of time.
Ile utamu iko hapa, watafurahia sana.
What comes to your mind when you think of the perfect home for your family? Is it the beauty, the comfort, the security, the convenience, or even the affordability? Victory Gardens offers exactly that and much more. It is just 10 minutes drive from Kitengela Town and 3.8 kilometers off the tarmac. This gated community project comes with solar street lighting, maram roads, beautiful trees, 24-hour security, and water connected to every plot. The best part is, families are already living here. Call us today on 0790 300 300 or visit www.optiven.co.ke.
Optiven Limited, the pay-saters in real estate.
We are constantly worried about how clean our homes and offices are and how to get rid of germs on all the surfaces we come into contact with. Well, worry no more. Ace Multipurpose Surface Cleaner is your trusted brand for killing germs. Ace Multipurpose Surface Cleaner fights and kills germs and bacteria, degreases and cleans your surfaces and floors, kills and prevents growth of mold and mildew, disinfects. Mix one cupful of Ace Multipurpose Cleaner with 1 liter of water and wipe all your surfaces at home or in the office. Ace, we make your home feel brand new.
Rashes again? Kiss Kids diapers. Kiss Kids, no rashes. Kiss Kids, no rashes. Bye-bye rashes, bye diapers, choose Kiss Kit.
Na baba Brenda.
Mume wako anakubali mwende hospitali pamoja? Wangu hata nimlipe, hauwezi kubali.
Ilibidi twende na yeye, nipimwe. Yeye apimwe. Kama kuna HIV, nipewe dawa ndio mtoto asipate HIV.
Wanaume wenzangu, kuandamana na mama akienda clinic na pia kujua hali yako ya HIV ni muhimu. Inaonyesha unamjali na pia unajali mtoto wako mtarajio. Je, unajijua?
Unapoendelea kujikinga kutokana na HIV, tafadhali zingatia taratibu zote za serikali za kujikinga na virusi vya corona.
Afya bora, maisha bora. Jipime, jiinue.
The Kenya School of Revenue Administration, KESRA, is the leading capacity builder of choice in tax, customs and fiscal policy in Africa. It is one of the only 4 World Customs Organization WCO accredited regional training centers in East and Southern Africa. KESRA is also the regional training institution for African Tax Administration Forum, ATAF, and the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, OECD. Charter career or business path in tax consultancy, audit, customs, clearing and forwarding, shipping, and financial advisory. Now is your time. Apply now for certificate courses in Tax Administration, Customs Administration and East Africa Customs Freight Forwarding Practicing Certificate, EACFFPC. Diploma programs in Tax Administration, Customs Administration. Higher National Diploma in Tax Administration, Customs Administration. Postgraduate Diploma programs in Tax Administration, Customs Administration, Master's Program in Tax and Customs Administration with specialization in Tax or Customs. The Kenya School of Revenue Administration. transcending to excellence. This is NTV.
You are watching NTV Tonight, and the broadcast begins with an update of the COVID-19 statistics. Globally, there are over 9.6 million people infected with the coronavirus. 487,347 people have died from it. On the continent, the number of infections stand at 340,805, while 8,907 have died. Meanwhile, in the United States, their cases stand at 2,478,722. The death toll is over 124,000. Kenya's numbers shortly, but first, the day's top stories.
Tonight.
Today, when you look at him, he's a broken man.
Sirisia MP John Waluke begs for mercy. But the law begins its harvest in the May scandal. And also tonight, it's another day of drama at the Nairobi County Assembly. We tell you what this one's all about. Plus, another one brutalized and killed in Nandi over a face mask. And the police reckon with a people's anger. And also tonight, the army of intruders prowling the streets in the day.
Metendewa wizi mara mingi, hasa kwa hii mwezi, visa vimetendeka ni vinne, lakini hatujaona tukivanyiwa haki yetu.
And a police service unable to serve and protect.
NTV Tonight with Smriti Vidyarthi.
Thanks for joining us. Flora Atieno is our sign language interpreter tonight. Well, tonight, Sirisia Member of Parliament John Waluke and his co-accused Grace Wakungu are looking at serving a seven-year jail term if they fail to pay the close to 2 billion shilling fine imposed by the court after they were found guilty of defrauding the National Cereals and Produce Board. Chief Magistrate Elizabeth Juma, while sentencing them and despite their pleas for mercy, reprimanded the two for taking advantage of the drought situation back in 2004 to profit. Zainab Ismail breaks down the five-hour ruling.
They sat at the dock, pensively waiting for the ruling that would seal their fate. The pin drop silence in the court as Magistrate Elizabeth Juma wrote her ruling was spine-chilling. After all, this ruling was one for the history books. The sentencing that began at approximately 2:30 p.m. took 5 hours to conclude. The Sirisia legislator and co-accused Grace Wakungu had their heads bowed for most of the time, perhaps in a silent prayer. And finally, it was time to reap what they sowed.
The first and second accused are directed to pay. In default, each of them shall serve a further 7 years imprisonment.
Waluhe and Wakungu are expected to pay 727 million shillings, 727,562 shillings, and 707 million, 725,562 shillings, respectively.
This is an issue that can affect any Kenyan.
This is according to Section 48(1)(b) of the Anti-Corruption and Economic Crimes Act, which states that if an accused is found guilty of benefiting from a corrupt act, they face a mandatory fine of double the quantified benefit they derived. During mitigation before they were sentenced, the defense team made a passionate appeal to the court to grant leniency to the convicted duo, owing to their ages and roles in society.
We are begging, Your Honor, we are not demanding for it, we are begging that you give us the most lenient sentence, and that is provided for in the fundamental rights.
This is a member of parliament with a lot of impunity. They do what they do. May it go on record that the alleged offense was committed not when he was a member of parliament.
The two will now have to contest the ruling at the High Court after their defense team unsuccessfully appealed for suspension of the sentence. The ruling is subject to appeal within 14 days. Zainab Ismail, NTV.
Well, former Deputy Chief Justice Nancy Barasa and prominent city lawyer Ahmed Nasir Abdullahi are among those who may have benefited from the 313 million shillings paid to Sirisia MP John Waluke and his company by the National Cereals and Produce Board. Barasa is said to have been paid for legal services, while Abdullahi also received payments in various installments through an account at the First Community Bank. The documents by the Ethics and Anti-Corruption Commission lift the lid on how the fraud was woven together. NTV's Silas Apollo has those details.
Details have now emerged about what investigators said was a complex web used by Sirisia MP John Waluke and his business associates to swindle the government hundreds of millions of shillings. Documents tabled by the Ethics and Anti-Corruption Commission in court show that Waluke, alongside Grace Wahungu and the late controversial businessman Jacob Juma, used the services of prominent lawyers and banks to carry out their activities. Part of this web was former Deputy Chief Justice Nancy Barasa and prominent city lawyer Ahmed Nasir Abdullahi. Barasa was paid for offering legal services to Erad Supplies, while Abdullahi is said to have received payments in installments, running into tens of millions of shillings through his law firm Ahmed Nasir and Abdi Kadir and Company Advocates. The first payment of 35 million shillings to Abdullahi said to have been made to the firm on March 20, 2013. This was followed by another payment of 5 million shillings the next day. The transactions were from the National Cereals and Produce Board's account operated by the KCB Bank and were authorized by Soita and Saende Advocates. In this transaction, Barasa is said to have received 5 million shillings as part of legal fees, while Waluke received 50 million shillings and another 40 million shillings paid to Grace Wahungu. Abdullahi would later receive another 13 million shillings on July 2, 2013 through the same Soita and Saende Advocates, and another $24,000, around 2.4 million Kenya shillings, on the same day. His firm would later receive another 14,000 shillings the next day. The payments were made from the NCPB's accounts held at the National Bank of Kenya and the Cooperative Bank. The ESCC says that while it could not authenticate why the lawyers were paid, the funds were part of the 313 million shillings in payments awarded to Erad Supplies Limited by a tribunal. Waluke, Wahungu and the late businessman Jacob Juma had moved to the tribunal to compel the NCPB to pay them, accusing the board of breaching a contract it had entered with Erad Supplies for the supply of maize for famine relief in 2004. The firm, however, never supplied the maize. Silas Apollo, NTV.
Right, that is certainly a story that we will keep close tabs on. Elsewhere, in another episode of the City Hall drama, after two groups of Nairobi MCAs clashed over the 2020-2021 budget that allocates the Nairobi Metropolitan Services about 27 billion shillings and the governor just 9 billion shillings, some MCAs who spent the night at the assembly claimed their counterparts wanted to pass the financial year budget without the approval of the entire house. The scuffle led to the arrest of former clerk Jacob Ngwele. Kennedy Murethi has more.
These were the scenes at the Nairobi County Assembly as an impasse pitting MCAs allied to Governor Mike Sonko and those who support Speaker Beatrice Elachi ensued.
Security alert.
All those thought to be close to Governor Sonko were not allowed into the building as they were thought to have a sinister motive.
We've been denied entry, and with no prior communication, I don't know what is happening. I'm just being told that the people who are inside are enough, and they are trying to adhere according to, you know, COVID. I don't know. Anyway, I just don't understand what is happening.
The day's agenda was the passage of the 2020-2021 budget. And in the minds of those who support Speaker Elachi, dissenting MCAs wanted to disrupt the process and make sure the Nairobi Metropolitan Services does not get the money it needs.
NMS has 27.3 billion shillings that is owed to them because of the transferred functions. And the Nairobi County has 9 billion. So Abdi Hassan Guyo, together with Paul Kados and some people that they were calling Jubilee Bigwigs, I do not know them, had a meeting last night at Kasolin, and they said that they have to come here at 4 in the morning.
Speaker Elachi is said to have led about 40 MCAs into spending the night at the assembly after word went round that some MCAs led by Matopeni MCA Abdi Guyo would interrupt the proceedings. And at about 5 a.m., the splinter group arrived, and a scuffle ensued before they retreated.
I don't have any personal issues with her, and she has no mandate or locus standi to say who is supposed to be the leader in any political parties in the county assembly. She is crossing the line.
Guyo says he was only attending proceedings as he had been reinstated as the leader of majority in the assembly by Jubilee Party Secretary General Raphael Tuju. He dismissed claims that he was there to throw the proceedings into disarray.
There is rumors going around that we are on a mission of, for example, getting rid of Elachi as our speaker. That we have not been told by anybody.
Security had been heightened at all assembly entrances in the lead up to the afternoon session. The budget was later approved this afternoon. Kennedy Murethi, NTV.
Now, three people have been killed in Nandi County as passions stoked by the shooting and killing of a disabled man by a policeman roiled. Inspector General of Police Hilary Mutyambai says the officer involved will be interdicted as police came face to face with mounting anger of increasing cases of brutality. Here is Gabriel Kudaka with the details.
The fires of confrontation had been lit. Protesters, angered by the killing of a disabled man, railed at what they termed as yet another case of police impunity. The charged residents set alight a house belonging to the OCS. The fires were started by the shooting of 39-year-old Lazaro Tirop, a cobbler, who was shot after he tried to intervene, seeking the release of a man who had been arrested for not wearing a face mask.
Our police wanatua kwa sababu ya shilingi hamsini. Shilingi hamsini peke yake haiwezi cost maisha ya mwanadamu.
The residents barred police officers who were trying to pick up his body. Police had to use tear gas to disperse the mob that was marching towards the police station. Two more people were killed in the ensuing scuffle.
Mutu angali hapa tuko na uchungu sana kwa sababu mutu ameuawa bure bila hatia.
Ya huyu mwenye amelala hapa kwa mujibu ya sheria hiyo haki lazima itafanywe.
Police Inspector General Hilary Mutyambai says The officer involved in the shooting will be interdicted as the police service contends with mounting anger over increasing cases of police brutality and amid investigations into the deaths of more than 100 people in the hands of police since the beginning of the year.
The officers who is involved takes personal responsibility.
The Independent Policing Oversight Authority says it will also investigate the shooting to ascertain if the use of force in that case was necessary. Gabriel Kudaka, NTV.
Police brutality needs to stop. It is as simple as that. We will keep close eyes on that story as the investigations continue. Right at this point, you are about to witness something rather interesting that took place in South Africa before we take a break. And this was on South Africa's coastline. Have a look at these surfers who were out in the ocean, almost oblivious to the fact that there was a great white shark swimming right close to them, not even a meter away. Absolutely fascinating. Authorities there have now warned surfers and beachgoers to be wary of the presence of sharks that have been witnessed using drone footage. Stay with us, we're taking a break.
The risk of illness-causing germs is increasing. It is believed that the coronavirus can remain on surfaces in your home for up to 9 days. Touching infected surfaces is one of the ways in which germs spread. Regularly disinfect your floors, countertops, and kitchen surfaces with bleach, and use an effective toilet cleaner inside and outside your toilet bowl. This message is brought to you by Medifacts, Jig, and Harpic.
What comes to your mind when you think of the perfect home for your family? Is it the beauty, the comfort, the security, the convenience, or even the affordability? Victory Gardens offers exactly that and much more. It is just 10 minutes drive from Kitengela Town and 3.8 kilometers off the tarmac. This gated community project comes with solar street lighting, Maram roads, beautiful trees, 24-hour security, and water connected to every plot. The best part is families are already living here. Call us today on 0790 300 300 or visit www.optiven.co.ke.
Optiven Limited, the pay satyrs in real estate.
For a better tomorrow, don't forget to do the 1-2-3 with Colgate every night.
John suffers from indigestion. His twin James suffers from heartburn. Sometimes it's the other way around or both. That's why they use Gaviscon Double Action. It soothes within 3 minutes and lasts up to 4 hours. For double relief from heartburn and indigestion, Gaviscon Double Action. If symptoms persist, seek medical advice.
Explorers of the night, wale wase wa kuhasolu siku, kustreama movies, music mix diehards, and gaming fanatics. We've heard you. It is now your time to fly your flag high. Do what you love, mpaka che na Telkom. Join Usiku Sako with Telkom night bundles that allow you rule the night at prices you love. Join our tribe, Usiku Sako Squad. Just dial *544# from your Telkom line and select the night bundle of your dreams. You are the legend the night needs.
Disinfect and protect your home with Jik. Jik kills 99.9% of illness-causing germs. Disinfect floors, kitchen and bathroom surfaces and wash white clothes, towels and dishcloths with Jik bleach. Just Jik it.
My whole life is in my phone.
Welcome back to NTV Tonight. Let's now take a look at the latest local numbers regarding the coronavirus, and 178 more people tested positive for COVID-19 from 3,918 samples, raising the total caseload to 5,384. But 34 people were discharged from hospital to bring the total number of recoveries to 1,857. Two more people have succumbed to the disease, bringing the national death toll to 132. Nairobi County still has the highest number of infections, with 100 new cases. Kajiado has 21, Migori 17, Kiambu 16, Busia and Mombasa 7, and Nakuru 2. Uasin Gishu, Kericho and Taita Taveta each recorded one case. Well, with just 11 days to the lapse of the restrictions to stop the spread of the virus, President Uhuru Kenyatta now says the decision to reopen the country lies with the county's ability to respond to a surge in the number of infections. So far, only 12 counties have set up the required 300-bed capacity isolation facilities. Leila Mohammed reports that the Council of Governors called for a gradual reopening of the economy, subject to the setting up of a strict regime of containment protocols.
As the number of infections race towards a peak, the head of state is weighing in on what the future looks like and the delicate decisions he has to make.
County governments and their readiness to respond to new imported cases of infection will also equally largely determine our national readiness to reopen the country as a whole.
The Council of Governors says the movement restrictions should not be lifted unless the proposed strategies to enhance testing and screening at county boundaries, contact tracing, are adequately implemented. They also want the curfew in place for as long as it takes to flatten the curve. So far, only 12 counties have attained isolation facilities with a 300-bed capacity. 34 counties are working to put in place the facilities before the 30-day period lapses. However, 16,914 health personnel had been trained on COVID-19 management, among them 59,449 community health volunteers.
They're able to be able to, you know, work as monitors and evaluators of our home-based care program.
COG is banking on 4.6 billion shillings, which it is asking national government to release under the devolution support program. And while both tiers of government fight on one front, those on the front lines are fighting other battles in their minds as the pandemic takes an emotional toll.
For over 3 months now, healthcare workers across the country have been taking care of the health needs of various COVID-19 patients within this country. But at the moment, the ministry now says it is important to take care of them for them to help others.
Doctors, nurses, lab people, they also cry. They feel pain.
The healthcare workers can now call and speak to a mental health specialist. The call service will be available 24 hours a day.
We have people across the country, actually in 45 counties, that can be called upon to be able to provide the psychosocial support.
Leila Mohammed, NTV.
Elsewhere, as police officers take over the streets at night to enforce the nationwide curfew, robbers are taking over the streets during the day. The DCI in Kilimani now says they are investigating an incident where a man was robbed by two armed men in broad daylight. The robbery was caught on CCTV. But as NTV's Naoma Sampao reports, it's not an isolated incident.
The CCTV clip that went viral on social media showed the chilling early morning robbery. A well-clad man robbed by two thugs. One had a gun and another had a knife. The ordeal lasted about 10 seconds. The man, who was carrying a backpack and walking on the sidewalk, had been ambushed by two men who could not easily be identified as they wore hoodies and masks. They then made away with his laptop bag. Kenyans Online called for enhanced security before the Directorate of Criminal Investigations in Kilimani picked it up, promising to investigate. But for many Kenyans, such brazen acts are part of everyday life. In Kisii, an unprecedented wave of robberies is robbing them of easy sleep. The cases have increased since the country was in the grips of the coronavirus pandemic. One such robbery in Nyamacho was caught on CCTV. A middle-aged man hit an M-Pesa outlet in the township and made away with about 120,000 shillings. Residents now accuse the police of laxity.
Wanatembelea maduka ya M-Pesa sana na wanapima jinsi ambao wanafanya biashara. Huwa sasa saa nyingine tunafumilia.
Tumetendewa wizi mara mingi hasa kwa hii mwezi. Visa vimetendeka ni vinne. Lakini hatujaona tukivanyiwa haki yetu.
The residents worry that the situation is deteriorating even as they grapple with reduced incomes and interrupted livelihoods owing to the COVID-19 pandemic. Nayoma Sampao, NTV.
Well, if you're out and about during the day or in the early evening before the close of the curfew, do be sure you keep safe. Now, as if battling the pandemic isn't enough, a late-night fierce fire that ravaged a section of the Gikomba market has once again left a community in desolation. And while the government promises these residents some form of comfort, a number of them have been numbed by the constant blows and the delays in responding to a fresh outbreak. Ngina Kirori has more.
If there is one thing that has been proven countless times about the Kenyan spirit, is that it is resilient. That is the life story of the people of Gikomba, who have had to contend with fires on a nearly yearly basis. The latest happened last night at 2 a.m., leaving scenes such as these. The fires had died down to embers, but the acrid smell of the huge plumes of smoke still pierced the air. And while others were trying to scrap together pieces of their now ashen businesses and residences, others could only stand back and watch as the firefighters battled the last flames.
The fire that brought down a section of the Gikomba market here late last night has been described as the worst seen yet in the unfortunate series that is the Gikomba fires. But the government says they are planning to put in measures to mitigate the effects of the fire 3 months from now.
This will include constructing a perimeter wall, mounting CCTV cameras, and constructing a borehole to ensure water is easily accessible.
With immediate effect, we are going to assemble them together and give each one of them 10,000 shillings.
Some residents are, however, still bitter over the poor response time of emergency services. Dennis Okoth, who previously owned a printing shop here, has now been forced back to the drawing board.
Tunaona sasa ndio wanachangamka ati ndio wanataka sasa kuzimazima vitu zenye vitu zishaungua kila kitu.
The fire is suspected to have been yet another arson attack. The government now says it will spend between 23 to 25 million to help the displaced business owners and families. Gina Kirori, NTV.
All right, we do need a breather, and this video might just uplift the mood. Well, it certainly did mine when I watched it. Meet Gloria, the baby hippopotamus that was born at a zoo in France. Now, most births take place at night, but zookeepers were able to witness the miracle of life. In the wild, the mother isolates herself from the group to avoid risking the life of her calf. So the zoo recreated her natural habitat, and Gloria will have to soon get accustomed to living in a pond. Look at her. All right, back after this break.
Like every mother, I'm worried about dangerous insects, especially mosquitoes, which spread diseases like malaria to my loved ones. This year, I'm not afraid. I'm using Mortein Doom. Mortein Doom All Insect Killer provides protection in seconds. Not even a single mosquito is spared, because even one mosquito bite can cause malaria. Mortein Doom provides protection in seconds.
The County Government of Nyeri, with the approval of His Excellency Governor Mutahi Kahiga, has granted a 100% waiver of accrued interest sums on outstanding land rates, which has been extended to 30th June 2020.
With a cashless system, obtain your invoice from respective sub-county offices and make payments through accounts held at Cooperative Bank or Kenya Commercial Bank Nyeri branch, using account numbers on your screen, or M-Pesa Pay Bill 191900 and get your official receipt.
Enjoy the naturally appealing taste of our unique fruit blends. Every sip will delight your taste buds as they explode with flavor. It's only natural you invite your family and friends to your kind of world. An exciting world of six different flavors to pick from. Represent who you naturally are with Juice Juice Drink. Naturally ours with no added preservatives. A quality product from Bidco Africa.
Do your gums hurt?
Yeah.
Does your toothpaste contain sage, eucalyptus, myrrh, chamomile?
All that in one toothpaste?
Yes, try Colgate Herbal. Colgate Herbal contains nature's best herbs and Colgate's fluoride technology to give you strong teeth and healthy gums.
Ah, Colgate Herbal.
Let's go. Colgate Herbal for strong teeth and healthy gums naturally.
Sona Moja imetengenezwa kwa njia speciali ili kupambana na maumivu kwa haraka. Sona Moja ina aspirin kama kiungo. Sona Moja, kitulizo kamili. Maumivu ya kizidi, pata ushauri wa daktari.
We all are looking for products to protect ourselves from viruses. But not all products protect us. Did you know that using Dettol soap and water protects against viruses? Many viruses are surrounded by an envelope with receptors that enable them to enter a human cell and cause infection. Dettol soap destroys the outer layer of the virus and effectively removes it. Protect your family from the spread of viruses with Dettol. Dettol cleans and is now tested and proven to be effective against COVID-19 virus. This has been Medifax for Dettol.
That's not snitching. That's putting the government in check. But then again, atakama ni snitching, you do realize Miguna is the last born in a large family. Kwanza Miguna is a unique last born. He's the only last born najua haelewani na baba kabisa. Maybe that's why I need to say it kwa mama.
Make the young people understand doing it at the right time and the consequences of also of doing it at the wrong time.
And when it comes to the right time, I believe Dr. Ezekiel Mutua means the right time, not before curfew.
His Excellency Wycliffe Ambetsa Oparanya is pleased to notify property owners within Kakamega County of his decision to extend a 100% waiver. The waiver has been extended from 1st June to 31st August 2020.
All right, I've got the business news lined up for you now. And out of every 100 shillings lent out by commercial banks through loans to the private sector, 23 shillings had been restructured by the end of May 2020. This is an indication of efforts by Kenyans to secure more favorable repayment terms in view of the COVID-19 shock. Now, this has been revealed by the Central Bank of Kenya through its Monetary Policy Committee statement released this evening, which shows that 679 billion shillings worth of loans had been restructured by the end of May. The Central Bank's Monetary Policy Committee has, for the second consecutive month, retained the benchmark lending rate at 7%, stating that policy measures adopted since March are having the intended effect on the economy. The Apex Bank notes that a significant rebound in exports was observed in May and so far in June, with horticulture exports almost at normal levels, mainly due to a pickup in demand and easing of supply restrictions in key destination markets. Remittances also recovered in May to 200 $258.2 million from $208.2 million in April. Now, on Tuesday this week, members of Parliament deliberated on the Finance Bill of 2019. And amongst other things, they also endorsed the withdrawal of the value-added tax exemption status of solar equipment. Stakeholders in the renewable energy sector are now decrying the decision, saying it will reverse the gains Kenya has realized in its renewable energy sector and lead to job cuts. Judith Cherono filed the details.
In his June 13, 2020 budget speech, Treasury Cabinet Secretary Ukur Yatani vowed to rationalize tax exemptions as the government sought ramp up revenue mobilization to finance its ambitious 3.2 trillion shillings budget. On the Treasury's radar was the renewable energy sector, where persons dealing in solar energy equipment has been enjoying exemption from value-added tax, which accounts for 25% of Kenya's tax revenue. Stakeholders in the sector say this will have adverse effects on the economy.
There have been over 20,000 jobs created by the off-grid and mini-grid sector in Kenya, and over 65,000 jobs created in the communities that they serve. So altogether, nearly 85,000 jobs have been created by this sector, and they will continue to be created if the prices are kept down, because these customers cannot afford expensive products.
The stakeholders are also challenging the retabling and adoption of the proposal to impose VAT on solar equipment, given the fact that it had earlier been thrown out by the National Assembly during the Tax Laws Amendment Bill debate.
This VAT exemption was just brought to the Parliament during the amendment bill discussions just a month and a half ago. And now it was thrown back in for the finance bill just now, only 6 weeks later. And they have not waited for the 6 months.
With the executive having lost its bid to tax pension income and liquefied petroleum gas in the coming financial year, it is unlikely that there will be any efforts to reverse the adoption of the value-added tax in solar equipment. Kenyans now wait to see how this will impact the sector. Judith Cherono, NTV, Nairobi.
In just 2 days, the Globe will be marking the World Small and Medium-Sized Enterprise Day, at a time when most SMEs are struggling to cope with the COVID-19 shock. Our reporter Gabriel Kudaka took to the streets of Eldoret to understand how one SME is coping up with the new norm of disrupted supply chains.
The outbreak of COVID-19 has impacted negatively on many businesses, forcing some to come up with creative ways of staying afloat.
Many small and medium-sized businesses are now investing in digital solutions to cope.
Since COVID-19 came, we've seen a significant reduction in sales.
Caroline Chobet, a cashier at one of the restaurants in Eldoret, answers a call from a client making inquiries about their products. The client made the inquiry after visiting their social media platform.
Our customers make phone calls and we deliver the products, or rather the food items, to their home.
And after making the payment electronically, the food is packed and given to a motorbike rider who embarks on a journey to deliver it. We followed up the rider along the way from the restaurant to the client's residence. 15 minutes later, we arrive at John Kennedy's residence in Elgon View Estate in Eldoret, a client who had placed an order.
I've received it. Iko vizuri sana. Nimeconfirm pia ni kitu nimeorder.
Sasa hata sisi kama wana boda boda, imetusaidia ili tupate kazi hapo ndani.
Gabriel Kudaka, NTV.
The International Monetary Fund now warns that the COVID-19 pandemic will cause a larger decline in economic productivity than earlier anticipated. Speaking whilst releasing the fund's World Economic Outlook, Chief Economist Geeta Gopinath said the global economy is expected to contract by 4.9% in 2020, with estimated losses standing at $1.2 trillion over the next 2 years.
this would really help with that.
Reti, Deputy Director of the IMF's Research Department.
As countries reopen, the pickup is uneven. On the one hand, pent-up demand is leading to a surge in spending in some sectors like retail. On the other hand, contact-intensive sectors like hospitality, tourism, and travel remain depressed.
Now, local leaders from Western, North Rift and Nyanza regions have urged the government to firmly rein in on the illegal importation of cheap sugar into the country. Speaking in Kakamega, the 15 MCAs threatened to storm the border posts at Busia and Malaba in a bid to restrain the illegal importation, which they say hurts the local farmer. The MCAs want the government to deal with the sugar cartels once and for all.
Sukari hii imefika sasa iko hata katika maduka, iko katika wholesale, inauzwa wazi. Na tunajiuliza je, sisi kama hii sukari tutairuhusu iendelee kuingia, wakulima wetu watakuwa namna gani?
Wao wamesahau wakulima ambao walianza na wao kufanya hizi vibanda viwanda zikaweze kunawiri.
All right, well, next up it is well, we're taking a break, I beg your pardon, next up. And just have a look at how a business in Bolivia is trying to keep afloat during the COVID-19 pandemic. One company is offering virtual tours and visits with this animal. It's called a llama, on a video conference app, giving visibility and income to rural communities dependent on tourism. Now, the llama is an essential part of Bolivia, and the virtual tour allows people to see where llamas live and originated from and meet the locals who care for them daily.
Wa Kenya, hii fight hatukuchagua, lakini tuko na choice. Tuchague kujilinda. Tuchague kuprotect familia zetu. Tuchague usafi. Kuosha mikono. Kuosha manyumba zetu. Ndiyo tulinde watoto wetu. Na tuvae mask. Future yetu iko mikononi mwetu. Kenya, let's do it for the ones we love.
Sasa ruka.
Nini? Ulikuwa tayari kujangamka?
Si ungesema?
Changamkia vipindi vipendavyo, vichekesho, muziki, habari za interneti na mengine mengi. Jione YouTube na Tembo. Dial *544# and select YouTube.
Helen Paul.
Hello, madam. Would you like to join us on this mission?
Yes, but how?
Just one question for you. How do you keep your toilet clean?
I use regular detergent and bleach for washing and removing yellow stains. I've been using it for years.
Oh, madam, the regular detergents and bleach are used for washing clothes. To disinfect your toilet properly, you need Harpic 10X. It is specially made for germs and stains removal. Harpic's thick formula settles on stains and gives 10 times better cleaning compared to regular detergents and bleach.
Wow, now I'm convinced, Helen Paul.
Really?
Yeah.
Now that she's part of the mission, the next house is yours.
I help women find independence by training them in fish farming. It's tough on my back, joints, and can cause headaches. Panadol Extra relieves multiple types of pain. Panadol Extra, now with new Optizorb technology to fight multiple tough pains with 3 times more pain-relieving medicine in the first 30 minutes when you need it most. Seeing them support themselves makes any pain worth it. If symptoms persist, seek medical advice.
Here we are, living in the moment. And here we are, dreaming in the open. Look around, isn't this a new day? a move, doing things a new way, a new way. Cause this is our world, and this is our time. These are our plans, we're gonna let them shine. This is our place, in the human race. And we won't stop dreaming, no we won't stop dreaming.
The future of our nation relies on your dreams and our steel. Tononoka Group, at the core of every construction.
Have you filed your 2019 tax returns? You have few days remaining. Do it today and avoid the last minute rush. Log on to itax.kra.go.ke.
That's not snitching. That's putting the government in check. But then again, Atakama is snitching. You do realize Miguna is the last born in a large family. Kwanza Miguna is a unique last born. He's the only last born najua haelewani na baba kabisa. Maybe that's why I need to sit kwa mama.
Make the young people understand doing it at the right time and the consequences of also of doing it at the wrong time.
And when it comes to the right time, I believe Dr. Ezekiel Mutua means the right time, not before curfew.
His Excellency Wycliffe Ambetsa Oparanya is pleased to notify property owners within Kakamega County of his decision to extend a 100% waiver. The waiver has been extended from 1st June to 31st August 2020.
Welcome back. The Directorate of Criminal Investigations has put together a team of elite officers to unravel a fake arms deal involving a firm in Mali, a lawyer, and dragging in the Ministry of Interior. NTV's Seth Olale reports that the ministry has since distanced itself from the scam.
No arrests have so far been made into the fake arms scandal involving lawyer Jacob Olo against Malian arms dealers and roping in the Ministry of Interior. The Directorate of Criminal Investigations has now set up an elite team drawn from the Special Crimes Unit and the Anti-Fraud Unit to spearhead the investigations that were being conducted by the DCIO Kasarani. The DCI was on Wednesday allowed to scrutinize the lawyer's bank account at the Gulf Africa Bank as investigators try to unravel the fraud. Detectives believe Olo, who is at the center of the fraud, received an initial payment of 7.5 million shillings that was supposed to be paid as commitment fees to enable Malian arms company called Premium Interservices get a tender to supply guns to the Ministry of Interior. Olo's law firm, known as Jacob Olo and Company Advocates, had in pro forma invoice, which we have since obtained, asked Premium Interservices to deposit $75,000 into its dollar account. When asked about the money, the lawyer on initial questioning alleged that the money was reversed immediately the transfer was initiated. Olo also alleges that he was only acting for clients who had approached him and had no prior knowledge of the kind of business they were involved in. The Ministry of Interior, however, says it is not aware of the deal involving the company based in Mali, Bamako, and which collapsed. Investigators are now looking for four other people who accompanied the lawyer to the Kasarani police station, saying they were members of the Witness Protection Agency. Seth Olale, NTV.
All right, elsewhere on the continent, Africa's first COVID-19 vaccine trial has begun in South Africa, with the country set out to target about 2,000 people with a vaccine. The vaccine developed by the Oxford Jenner Institute is already under evaluation in Britain and will also target 50 people living with HIV. The large-scale trial is being conducted in South Africa, Britain and Brazil.
South Africa recorded its highest death toll in a single day on Tuesday. 111 people died from COVID-19-related complications. South Africa has nearly one-third of Africa's confirmed cases, with more than 106,000, including more than 2,100 deaths. This week, about 2,000 volunteers have taken part in the first COVID-19 vaccine trial on the African continent at the Chris Hani Baragwanath Hospital in Soweto, South Africa.
I feel a little bit scared, but I want to know what's going on with this vaccine so that I can tell my friends and others what's going on in this time.
What's going to happen is that these 8 participants form part of what is known as Group 1, which is a group where is a small group of 50 individuals where we're trying to understand two important issues. The first issue is the safety of the vaccine, especially in terms of what would be common side effects, and the second issue is how well the body mounts an immune response against the vaccine.
World Health Organization Chief Tedros Adhanom urged the initial supply of any COVID-19 vaccine be deployed where it's most needed, rather than based on the ability to pay. South Africa implemented a strict nationwide lockdown on March 27th, but confinement measures are being gradually phased out to allow businesses to pick up and limit damage to an already ailing economy.
Right, some form of progress. At this point, we take another breather and I'll be back in a moment with the sports news. But before that, a couple in Uruguay have created a giant cake costume to celebrate birthdays despite the ban on big parties in Uruguay. Alexis and Estella drive and walk outside homes, pushing the volume of their loudspeaker to ensure that the spirit of the festivities reigns amidst orders of social distancing. On birthdays, Alexis plays audio messages sent to relatives who cannot be present.
Find independence by training them in fish farming. It's tough on my back, joints, and can cause headaches. Panadol Extra relieves multiple types of pain. Panadol Extra, now with new OptiZob technology to fight multiple tough pains with 3 times more pain relieving medicine in the first 30 minutes when you need it most. Seeing them support themselves makes any pain worth it. If symptoms persist, seek medical advice.
What comes to your mind when you think of the perfect home for your family? Is it the beauty, the comfort, the security, the convenience, or even the affordability? Victory Gardens offers exactly that and much more. It is just 10 minutes drive from Kitengela Town and 3.8 kilometers off the tarmac. This gated community project comes with solar street lighting, Maram roads, beautiful trees, 24-hour security, and water connected to every plot. The best part is families are already living here. Call us today on 0790 300 300 or visit www.optiven.co.ke.
Optiven Limited, the pay status in real estate.
How to burp a baby. Lay your baby face down on your lap. Support your baby's head, making sure it's higher than his or her chest. Gently pat or rub the baby's back, leaving the baby comfortable and without any trapped gas.
Kiss Kids diapers. Kiss Kids, no rashes. Kiss Kids, no rashes. Bye-bye rashes, bye diapers, choose Kiss Kids.
That's not snitching. That's putting the government in check. But then again, Atakaman is snitching. You do realize Miguna is the last born in a large family. Kwanza Miguna is a unique last born. He's the only last born najua haelewani na baba kabisa. Maybe that's why I need to say tikuwa man.
Make the young people understand. Doing it at the right time and the consequences of also of doing it at the wrong time.
And when it comes to the right time, I believe Dr. Ezekiel Mutua means the right time, not before curfew.
His Excellency Wycliffe Ambetsa Oparanya is pleased to notify property owners within Kakamega County of his decision to extend a 100% waiver. The waiver has been extended from 1st June to 31st August 2020.
Welcome back. Sports news now, and athletes who represented Kenya in various international competitions up to 2004 will be the beneficiaries of a nationwide campaign. The athletes, about 150 of them, are set to receive food rations from the National Olympic Committee of Kenya in partnership with the Kenya National Sports Council. The campaign was inaugurated by Sports Cabinet Secretary Amina Mohamed at the Nyayo National Stadium. While launching the campaign, the CS said that the ministry has already reached 2,400 sports people through its cash program.
And you actually had me apologize because we have, forgotten them in some way. And we're trying to correct that. We've asked, as I said before, for at least to be prepared, and the cast is here, for at least to be prepared of all our legends with their phone numbers, because we want to approach them directly. We don't want to go through anybody. Want to send money directly to their phones.
Now, New York's famed marathon planned for the 1st of November has been cancelled due to the coronavirus pandemic, according to the organizers. The world's largest marathon was set to celebrate its 50th anniversary this year. More than 53,000 runners finished the race last year, with Kenya's Jocelyn Jepkosgei and Jeffrey Kamworor leading the way to victory. Have a look at those pictures. Now, those registered for the 2020 edition will have a refund option, or they can defer entry to races in the next 3 years. The decision comes after weeks after Boston cancelled its marathon for the first time in the event's 124-year history. The Berlin Marathon, another major race, was also cancelled in a bid to halt the spread of COVID-19. The London Marathon has been postponed until October 4th, while the Tokyo Marathon was held with a reduced field of elite runners. The Chicago Marathon is still scheduled for October 11th. Football now, and Liverpool will be crowned English Premier League champions for the first time in 30 years if defending Manchester City failed to beat Chelsea tonight at Stamford Bridge. Liverpool thrashed Crystal Palace 4-0 at Anfield last night, and Trent Alexander-Arnold was on target with a superb free kick after 22 minutes before Mohamed Salah scored the second goal 1 minute before the break. Fabinho produced something even more special in the 54th minute when he drilled a magnificent finish past Wayne That's Hennessy nice from Salah. More than 27 metres. Sadio Mane scored the fourth goal in the 69th minute. Meanwhile, Manchester United overcame Sheffield United 3-0. Everton beat Norwich City 1-0. Wolves beat Bournemouth by a similar margin, as Aston Villa drew 1-1 rather at Newcastle.
Slick from Liverpool, special from Liverpool, Mane for Liverpool, absolutely brilliant from Liverpool.
Now, Real Madrid took the lead in the Spanish La Liga with a 2-0 win over Mallorca. Brazilian winger Vinicius Jr. scored the opener in the 19th minute. Real Madrid doubled the lead in the 56th minute as team captain Sergio Ramos netted a classy free kick. The victory boosted Real Madrid's points to 68 to top the standings. Like Real Madrid, second-placed Barcelona has 68 points in La Liga, which will conclude in 7 weeks' time. Atletico Madrid are third with 55 points. All right, now the match between Italian Serie A's two highest-scoring teams was all that and more. Atalanta fought back from two goals down to beat Lazio 3-2, putting a dent in the visitors' title hopes. The two teams are the most entertaining in Serie A and have scored 134 goals between them. Lazio came back from 3-0 down to draw 3-3 when they met earlier this season. It was Lazio's first match since 29th February and brought an end to its club record run of 21 matches undefeated. Lazio is now 4 points behind Serie A leader Juventus and 4 ahead of third place Inter Milan, which again gave away a lead to draw 3-3 against Sassuolo. Atalanta remained fourth, 4 points below Inter and 6 above fifth place Roma, which beat Sampdoria 2-1.
It's Lukaku against Consigli. 1-1. Right into the corner. Draghi. Sanchez, little combination, Biragi! 2-1 Inter! What an...
All right, that action does it for us on NTV tonight. I'm Smriti Vidyarthi. Great to have you with us. Flora Atieno has been our sign language interpreter tonight. It's 10 o'clock. Have yourselves a good night. Zainab Ismail will be with you tomorrow. Bye-bye.